sell over here in the United States. Probably all going to be very disappointed because from my point of view, it's 1 o'clock in the morning. I've still got jet lag. You'll probably find if there's anything worse than giving a talk at 1 o'clock in the morning, it's listening to one. But if you get too bored, you can go out. I think there's going to be a concert just down the road. You can hear Prokofiev's Love of Three Oranges, but that's pretty boring as well. So, yeah. I'm very sad about the weather because this is the third time I've been to the United States in the last couple of months. I've had to go to the Angeles twice to try and speed up the production of my third book about Archbishop Lefebvre. And being in my main job, I'm kind of sports master. I take soccer and cricket and things like that. And my ambition is to get a suntan to enhance my status next term. And both times when I went to Texas, they had lovely sunny weather. Literally, the day I got there, then it rained every single day while I was there. And then it was sunny again when I went back. And then I came here, and Mr. and Mrs. Marks, I said, what would I like to do tomorrow? Where would I like to go? I said, I'd just like to go out in your yard and lie in the sun and get a tan, but it will probably pour with rain, which it did. Was even a few years ago, I was in India, and in the dry season, it poured with rain when I was there then. So perhaps it's something to do with being British. But Mr. and Mrs. Marks' son, he's been over in England. I think he noticed it really does. It really does rain. It rains there nearly every day. It's always cool and chilly. But it's very, very disappointing when I've been reading about your heat wave. That's what I was really looking forward to. So, any of you want to know where I am in the USA, all you have to do is look at the weather forecast, those charts on the television, where it's raining, that's where I should be. Now, I'm supposed to talk about the Mass, but nearly everyone I've spoken to since I've been here, all they want to talk about is Archbishop Lefebvre. So I will, if possible, I'll try and not to make the talk too long, so then you can ask any questions about anything you like. So we'll get down to talking about the Tridentine Mass, because that, to a large extent, is what lies at the basis of the traditionalist movement. Can everyone hear me all right? Because I don't really need this microphone, but is it here for any purpose? I suppose we're going to begin at the beginning. Like, you've heard about the teacher who was taking the first communion class, and she said to the little girl, what's the first thing you have to do to make a good confession? She said, commit some sins. Which, actually, when you think about it, is perfectly true. So, I think it's sinking through to you. It is correct, isn't it? When we start thinking about the Mass, if we get down to it, what is the Mass all about? I like to think about the reply St. Michael, the Archangel, gave to Satan. You remember Satan wished him to take part in his rebellion at God, and St. Michael replied, you remember his famous reply, Quis ut Deus, who is like God, which of course is the Latin for the Hebrew Michael, which I quite like because it's my name, Mikael. You've noticed all the angels, the names end in El, which is a Hebrew word for God, and Michael means who is like God. And what he was getting at, of course, is that there's no one who's like God, because God is the creator, and we are his creatures. And God is finite, and we are infinite. God is infinite, and we are finite. And there can't be any comparison whatsoever to the creator and the creature, or the infinite and the finite. And we owe God everything. He owes us nothing at all. He needs nothing for us, but we need everything from him. So one of our primary duties in life, well, our primary duty is to offer God solemn and fitting worship. And the highest form of worship, of course, is sacrifice. And most of you, I'm sure, will have had a good Baltimore Catechism education. And you know that sacrifice is the offering of a victim to God by an appointed representative on behalf of the people. And that it's offered for four objects, for adoration, thanksgiving, contrition, and petition. And adoration, of course, means that we love God more than any other creature in the whole world. If we adore anyone, it's actually a sin. You're only allowed to adore God. And sacrifice has been found in all the major religions right from the beginning of the world. Apparently there are a few small ones, like the Australian Aborigines, apparently, who don't offer sacrifice, but most of the major religions do. Now, the Christian religion has only one sacrifice, and that is the same sacrifice offered by our Lord on the first Good Friday when, acting as priest and victim, he offered himself upon Calvary, making peace through the blood of the cross, both as to the things that are on earth and the things that are in heaven. So the holy sacrifice of the Mass is nothing less than the sacrifice of Calvary made present on our altars throughout the nations and the centuries. And it lies at the very heart of the Catholic liturgy. It might be useful just to say a word or two about liturgy, because you've had a new breed of people since Vatican II called liturgists. I don't think the word was ever heard before Vatican II, but most of them, they probably couldn't tell you what liturgy means or really what a liturgist is. And it comes from a Greek word, a liturgos. And a liturgos was a man who offered a public service on behalf of the community. There was a man in Athens, I think he fitted out a number of warships for the service of the state at his own expense. Now in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 2, our Lord is referred to as the liturgos of holy things. And so the liturgy is the holy thing that our Lord does on our behalf. So this is the first thing we have to fix in our minds concerning the liturgy, that it's not something that we do, it's something that our Lord does. He is the priest of every sacrifice. So every time we see a priest go up to the altar, he's offering Mass in persona Christi, in the person of Christ. And it's a very awesome to think that our Saviour and our God, he comes among us every day, renewing the sacrifice which he offered for us and which won us the hope of eternal life. Now I want to say a few words about the development of the Roman Rite. Now, quite a number of people, they use the term Mass for when they should use the term the Rite of Mass. Now, there's only one Mass. The Mass is actually the renewal of the sacrifice of Calvary. Every time a validly ordained priest uses the correct Matin form, we have the Mass. So there's no difference between our Mass, the Byzantine Mass, the Syrian Mass. Any valid form of Mass is the Mass, but there are many rites of Mass. And the rite of Mass, those are the prayers and ceremonies that surround the essential elements instituted by our Lord. And the essential elements of Mass, as I'm sure you all know, are that you must have a validly ordained priest, and you must have the correct matter and the correct form, which of course are wine and wheat and bread. In the Latin rite, it has to be unleavened. In the Eastern rites, it has to be leavened. Of course, if a Latin rite priest used leavened bread, it would still be a valid Mass. It would be what's called illicit, illegal, and the other way around. A Byzantine priest, if he used unleavened bread, he would be breaking the laws of his rite. But there are a large number of different rites of Mass. But each time the Mass is offered, it is the very same sacrifice. Now, up to the 4th century, the only liturgical book that was used was the Bible. But in the 4th century, people started writing down the different liturgies that they used, and the parent rites of all the different liturgies in use today can be discerned from the 4th century onwards. And what is important is that in each part of the world where liturgy developed, first of all the liturgy developed and was used, and then it was written down. So codification of the liturgy followed its use, not the other way around. Never once in the entire history of the Christian religion in any part of the world, in the East or in the West, did anyone ever set up a commission and gathered together a group of experts and said, let's compose a liturgy. That is not until after Vatican II. Well, actually, when I say in Christendom, I mean in Christendom in communion with the Pope, because of course Thomas Cranmer and the other reformers in the 16th century, they composed liturgies. Although to a very large extent, they mainly took the existing Catholic liturgy and just took out of it anything that didn't correspond with their particular heresies. Even they didn't have the idea of actually making up completely new prayers and ceremonies. A very well-known English historian, Professor Owen Chadwick, he said, liturgies are not made, they grow in the devotion of centuries, which is very useful little phrase to think about. Liturgies are not made, they grow in the devotion of centuries. It might surprise some of you to know that the very first written legislation concerning the Mass was the Bull Quo Primum of St. Pius V in 1570. There was no written legislation in the Roman Rite up to that time. Everything was done according to the law of custom. Now, the Missal of St. Pius V was published on the instructions of the Council of Trent, and it was intended to be an answer to the teaching of the Protestant reformers who attacked the Catholic theology of the Mass. The Council of Trent, it promulgated the Eucharistic teaching of the Catholic Church, which they said had to endure until the end of time. I'll give you a little quotation about this here. Yes, the Council of Trent said, "So this council teaches the true and genuine doctrine about this venerable and divine sacrament of the Eucharist, the doctrine which the Catholic Church has always held and which she will hold until the end of the world, as she learned it from Christ our Lord himself, from his apostles and from the Holy Ghost, who continually brings to mind all truth. The council forbids all the faithful of Christ henceforth to believe, teach, or preach anything about the most holy Eucharist that is different from what is explained and defined in the present decree." And so it seems quite reasonable to believe that the Council of Trent wanted the Mass, the rite of Mass that was to be promulgated in its name, to have the same permanence as its Eucharistic teaching. So from that standpoint, the term Tridentine Mass is rather unfortunate, because many people think that what we refer to as the Tridentine Mass was composed during or after the Council of Trent, which actually is completely untrue, because basically what St. Pius V did, he codified the existing order of Mass used in Rome, which in every essential respect is the same as the Roman Missal of 1474. I'm very fortunate, I've got the text of the Roman Missal of 1474, and you'll find for the ordinary of the Mass, that's the part that remains the same every day. And the proper of the Mass, it is virtually identical to the Missal used in right up to 1962. Now the Missal of 1474, again in every essential respect, that is identical to the order of Mass used in the time of St. Gregory the Great in the 7th century. And so the Missal of 1962 then is really the Missal of St. Gregory the Great. And I think it's better to refer to our Mass as the traditional Mass, not to give the impression it was composed in 1570, because I've seen statements by quite a few bishops and these so-called liturgists saying, well, if St. Pius V could compose a Mass in 1570, why couldn't Pope Paul VI compose one in 1969? Well, the answer is St. Pius V didn't compose a Mass in 1570, because the very idea of composing a Mass is completely alien to the entire Catholic ethos. It's just simply something that was never done. I'd like to read you a couple little quotations now from Father Adrian Fortescue, who was probably the greatest liturgical historian we had in the English-speaking world, at least at the beginning of this century. And he said about the Tridentine Mass, when we reached the point where it was promulgated, he said, "Since the Council of Trent, the history of the Mass is hardly anything but the composition and approval of new Masses. The scheme and all the fundamental parts remain the same. No one has thought of touching the venerable liturgy of the Roman Mass except by adding to it new propers." The propers, of course, when a new saint is canonized, they have their Mass put in the Missal, and they have their own readings. That's the proper. And when we think about that today, it seems very ironic, especially when we read what Father Fortescue says next. He said, "Certainly, we in the West may be very glad that we have the Roman Rite in the form of Pius V's Missal. There are many days still on which we say the Mass that has been said for centuries, back to the days of the Galatian and the Onine books. And when they do come, the new Masses only affect the proper. Our canon is untouched, and all the scheme of the Mass, our missal is still that of St. Pius V. We may be very thankful that his commission was so scrupulous to keep or restore the old Roman tradition. So then the Tridentine Mass, which we're dedicated to upholding, it's this Mass that goes right back to the time of St. Gregory the Great. It's the rite of Mass that Father Faber said it's the most beautiful thing this side of heaven. And it's the rite of Mass which Cardinal John Henry Newman wrote. He said, nothing is so consoling, so piercing, so thrilling, so overcoming as the Mass as it is said among us. I could attend Mass forever and not be tired. Well, Cardinal Newman is undoubtedly the greatest intellect in this century or the last century, certainly within the English-speaking world, and he said he could go to that form of Mass and never be tired. And yet these so-called liturgical experts, they tell us the Tridentine Mass was boring and it had to be changed, otherwise we'd end up with no one in church at all. This is the rite of Mass, actually, for which the martyr priests of England and Wales died. The missal in use before the Reformation in England, it was called the Sarum Missal. But the last one was published under Queen Mary Tudor. And when she died, you couldn't publish Sarum Missals anymore. So the priests who came in from Rome, the martyr priests, they brought in the Missal of St. Pius V. So it was actually the Missal of St. Pius V for which the martyr priests died. That's the missal that the missionaries who came to the United States brought to Maryland. It's the missal that the French martyr priests in Canada, of whom I'm sure you've read a lot, they endured sufferings that's so terrible it's hard even to think about them. It's actually the missal that St. Francis Xavier took to India, even though he went to India before 1570, because throughout the whole of Europe, although there was a variety of missals, in all essential respects they were identical to the missal promulgated by St. Pius V. So this missal, the Bible apart, is the church's greatest treasure. It was her pearl of great price, and something which should have been more sacred and more sacrosanct than anything else she possessed. And then we came to the Second Vatican Council. Now, as you know, Pope John had the idea of convoking this council in 1959. He said that this was as a direct result of an inspiration from the Holy Ghost, which we're by no means obliged to believe. Because even the Pope can have an inspiration from other sources. But the first document promulgated by the Council was its constitution on the sacred liturgy. The Latin name is Sacrosanctum Concilium, and it was promulgated on the 4th of December 1963, passed by an overwhelming majority. Even Archbishop Lefebvre signed it. And no one who read this constitution expected it to be a blueprint from revolution for a revolution. I better resist being a teacher. I was almost tempted to say, all those who have actually read it, would you please put your hands up? But I won't. But you'd probably find very few people here have ever actually read the council's constitution on the liturgy. But if you went to a typical parish meeting in an ordinary Novus Ordo parish, you might very well even find not only had not a single person read it, but not even the parish priest had read it. I know in my diocese, my bishop had never read it, because we complained in my own parish about they were going to destroy the sanctuary on the grounds that the Vatican Council had ordered that the altar should be brought forward facing the people. And it didn't say anything at all, but our bishop actually wrote back a very polite letter, and he told us the actual paragraph in the constitution where it said this. So we were able to send him back a photocopy of this paragraph in the constitution where it said nothing of the sort. So he had obviously asked one of his liturgical experts, or what do I say to these people, and it seems they hadn't read it either. So it is actually quite useful to have a copy of this constitution. There is a book, some of you might have seen it, by a man called Flannery, which is called Documents of Vatican II, and it's a useful book to have because it has all the actual 16 documents of the Second Vatican Council and a large number of the supplementary ones which have come out since. And there's a second volume come out now, further post-conciliar documents, which has useful things like Pope Paul VI's Credo of the People of God and Humanae Vitae, a lot of other very good documents in. Anyway, Many really traditional Catholics were really thrilled by this Liturgy Constitution, as a very, very well-known French traditionalist, one of the greatest French writers, Professor Louis Céloron, who wrote a book on the Mass, and he was really excited about the Liturgy Constitution, and he thought this was going to be actually a blueprint for a real renewal of the liturgy. Now, there was definitely a need for a renewal of the liturgy. France had really led the way in this. You see, in a typical parish mass in France, when you went along on Sunday, the people, when you went to the high mass, people would all sing it. They'd all sing the Gregorian chant. Some parishes had vespers in the evening, which is what St. Pius X wanted. St. Pius X wanted a renewal of the liturgy, but what he wanted was the existing liturgy used to its full potential. The way the liturgy was used before Vatican II, for most Catholics, they went to one low mass a week, and all the rest of the church's liturgy was just totally unknown to them. It's rather as if someone say, had a complete collection of all records of all the works of Beethoven and Mozart and Schubert, and perhaps they just kept playing Beethoven's fifth piano concerto over and over again and never heard one of the others. They'd be missing a lot. So there was room for the people to be brought to enjoy the riches of the liturgy. I don't know if anyone here has ever took part in the service of Vespers, which is a really beautiful one, or even Compline. There is, you can get from Keep the Faith, I must try not to go off on digressions, but a very beautiful recording of Compline, actually, made in England. And it's a lovely thing to play at night, actually, kind of sing along with it. Or even to get a little group of people from a parish such as yourself to meet perhaps once a week and learn to sing Compline, and gradually to extend your knowledge of the liturgy. And it's very, very inspiring and greatly deepens one's spirituality. But anyway, as I said, Professor Céloron and other traditional Catholics were very heartened by the Constitution on the liturgy. One of the outstanding liturgists of our time is a French priest called Father Louis Bouillet, who's an oratorian. And he was so excited by the Constitution on the liturgy, he wrote a book called The Liturgy Revived. He wrote that book in 1965 and prophesied the great renewal that was going to happen when this Constitution was implemented throughout the world. About 3 years later, I think it was 1968, he wrote another book, which some of you might have read, called The Decomposition of Catholicism. And this was the same man who'd been so enthusiastic a few years before. And he said, and this was before the new Mass was even promulgated, the way the changes had been made in the celebration of the Tridentine Mass, he said the people who were implementing the liturgical reform, they not only turned their backs on what the fathers of Vatican II had wanted, they had turned their backs on the entire liturgical movement and betrayed it. And he said, what we're witnessing isn't the promised renewal of Catholicism, but it's accelerating decomposition. Well, how could this have happened, that what apparently appeared to be a blueprint for renewal turned out to be a blueprint for disaster, for disintegration? Well, Archbishop Lefebvre gave the answer when he said that there were time bombs in the text of the Council. These time bombs, they were little phrases inserted by the experts who had drafted the documents. I expect most people here, you know what a paritus is or what the pariti were. That's slightly awkward because I know some people here have read all my books, so this must all be very boring for them because they've heard all this before, but probably some have never even seen one. So the word paritus is a Latin word for an expert, and the plural is pariti. Now, during the council, the documents were drawn up by these experts, and the bishops were supposed to vet them and vote for them. And a lot of these pariti, they were people who'd been under suspicion of modernism for many years before the council. Pope Pius XII had written an encyclical called Humani Generis, which I believe you can get that from St. Paul Publications. If you don't have it in your parish bookstore here, you ought to get it, because it seemed like a prophecy of everything that has happened in the church, especially as regards to doctrine on things like original sin. And Pope Pius XII warned about all teaching of certain theologians, and some of them were people like Father Yves Congar and Father Karl Rahner, who were greatly influenced the council. Another one, interestingly enough, who was under great suspicion, was a Father Ratzinger, who's now prefect of the Congregation for the Faith, but I think he has considerably revised his views since then. Now, what these Briti did, they put ambiguous phrases in these documents, which people wouldn't have noticed at the time, but which after the council they could use themselves. Now, if we had any liberals here today, which we don't, which is a pity because it livens things up. I hope some of you will be critical of things that I say, but they would say, well, how can you say this? What basis do you have for saying this? You traditionists are paranoid and you're making these things up. Well, now, Cardinal Heenan, who was one of the most active council fathers from England, this is what he said about the constitution on the liturgy. I'd like you to listen carefully to this. The bishops were under the impression that the liturgy had been fully discussed. In retrospect, it is clear that they were given the opportunity of discussing only general principles. Subsequent changes were more radical than those intended by Pope John and the bishops who passed the decree on the liturgy. His sermon at the end of the first session shows that Pope John did not suspect what was being planned by the liturgical experts. Well, you couldn't get anything more clear than this. Cardinal Heenan says the liturgical experts drafted this in a particular way because they were planning to make radical changes which the Pope and the bishops didn't suspect. So when people make these allegations, it's not just to the ravings of ignorant and paranoid traditional laymen. This is Cardinal Heenan said that, and a good number of other bishops have said it as well. That's an exaggeration to say a good number, but unfortunately there aren't a good number of really sound bishops. But your own American Archbishop Robert Dwyer of Portland, he said this, and he said, if you had told any of the bishops at the time they voted for the liturgy constitution what was going to happen, that the Latin liturgy would just virtually vanish from the church, he said they would have laughed at you at the time. The whole thing just seemed so improbable. Well, Cardinal Heenan, he quite rightly had a deep-rooted suspicion of the Pariti, and he warned, he said, God help us if the Pariti ever obtain the power to interpret the council to the world. But that is precisely what happened. When the council concluded, they had these documents of the council, which on the whole, they aren't too bad. None of them are very inspiring. None of them are really, terribly necessary. You could actually abolish all the 16 documents of Vatican II and forget they ever existed. I don't think anybody would lose by it. That might sound a bit of a radical thing to say, but if anyone can think of anything we would have lost if they did that, I'd like to hear it. But anyway, most of the documents weren't too bad. But they set up commissions to interpret them, and the Pariti took control of all these commissions. I've documented that in my book, Pope John's Council, where it's mentioned all the principal people on the post-conciliar commissions were taken from among the expert advisors to the council. And Archbishop Robert Dwyer said, the great mistake of the council fathers was to put the reform of the liturgy into the hands of the liturgical establishment, which I think he described it as a kind of a sacred elephant that tramped roughshod over the shards of a shattered liturgy. Well, now, there was one man who emerged after the council, a certain Father Bunini, who had been sacked by Pope John the 23rd. He had a very influential liturgical position on the pre-conciliar commission, which was preparing the liturgy constitution, and he was sacked by Pope John the 23rd. The reason why has never been revealed, but Pope John the 23rd, to a certain extent, he was rather a liberal pope, and he wouldn't have sacked anyone without a very good reason. But Paul VI brought Bunini back, and he became secretary of the post-conciliar commission, which was called the Concilium, with an S, which just means a committee of learned men. And as you probably know, for some, I was going to say it's a strange reason, but he co-opted a number of Protestants to advise this commission on reforming the Catholic liturgy and making changes in the Catholic Mass, which I find absolutely incredible, that you should get half a dozen heretics and ask them to advise you on reforming the holy sacrifice of the Mass. When he was challenged on this. He claimed, by the way, that these Protestant advisors had never taken any active part, and they'd just really been there as observers, which was completely untrue, because I wrote to one of them, a man called Canon Jasper, one of the English ones, and he told me they played a very active part all the way through. So Archbishop Giannini wasn't averse to stretching the truth a little now and again. And he eventually described, which is very revealing, he eventually described the new order of mass, which was eventually promulgated by Pope Paul VI. He described it as a major conquest of the Catholic Church. You can decide for yourselves what he meant by that. And he claimed it was a reform. But I'm sure all of us would maintain it wasn't a form, but it was a revolution. Now, I just want to read you a few small extracts from what the council actually said about the liturgy, just to show you what the intentions were compared with what we actually got. Well, one little example about Gregorian chant. The council says the church acknowledges Gregorian chant as proper to the Roman liturgy, therefore, other things being equal, it should be given pride of place in liturgical services. So the idea of the reform was, in many parishes, people had they had lots of sort of polyphonic masses by Italian composers, some who were of varying quality, but St. Pius X wanted Gregorian chant to be used. So the council ordered that Gregorian chant had to become the norm in every parish. The result following the council was that in the few parishes where they had Gregorian chant, it was dropped, and you ended up with practically no Gregorian chant at all. And another command of the council, this is the one I want to refer to now, is it said there must be no innovations unless the good of the church genuinely and certainly requires them. I'll just repeat that. There must be no innovations unless the good of the church genuinely and certainly requires them. Well, if any of you are discussing this matter with any friends of yours who might be thinking about coming to the traditional mass, or think that you shouldn't, or think that we're making a lot of fuss about nothing, tell them to get hold of a copy of the Preconciliar Missal. And imagine that they are a Protestant. Imagine that they, shall we say, a Baptist who doesn't believe in the real presence and who doesn't believe in the doctrine of sacrifice. And to go through their missal and make a light pencil tick beside every prayer and every ceremony, which if they were Protestants, they would wish to have expunged from the order of Mass. And then tell them to get a copy of the new order of Mass and have a look at it. And they will probably be very surprised to see that practically every prayer against which they put a little tick has been removed. The one big exception, of course, is the Roman canon. Now, Archbishop Giannini wanted to remove the Roman canon, and his concilium did, but Pope Paul VI intervened and insisted that it should be included in the Missal, which is the one saving grace of the new Missal. What it would have been, the implications would have been if the Roman canon had been dropped. It's just horrifying to think, which is an interesting manner in the way that God can use even a liberal pope to ensure that the church just doesn't actually go over the border into absolute unorthodoxy. I don't know how many of you ever read Hamish Fraser's magazine Approaches, but he kept pointing out how again and again and again Pope Paul VI would, when it came to what you call the bottom line over here, the nitty-gritty, he would usually come up with the orthodox thing, as in the question of Humani Vitae. He put out a marvellous encyclical called Mysterium Fidei about the Eucharist, which I don't think Archbishop Ferber could have written a sentence in it which could have been improved upon. So Paul VI intervened and kept the Roman canon in the new missal. So when the new mass is said with the Roman canon, it definitely is incompatible with Protestantism. No Protestant could use a communion service containing the Roman canon. But of course, the Roman canon is probably never used at all now. Now, going back to this little phrase I quoted to you about no innovations unless the good of the church genuinely and certainly required them. But you just think about a few of the prayers and the ceremonies, which of course most of you are used to. The beautiful psalm at the beginning, Judicame, where we hear the priest going up to the altar of God to offer a sacrifice. But of course no one has ever denied, even since the Vatican II, no pope, no spokesman of the Vatican has ever said that the Mass isn't a sacrifice. But how does the new Mass begin? By the priest greeting the people as if it's, you know, a Protestant assembly. Well, are you better Catholics today? Are your children better Catholics? Because the Judicame isn't said. If the good of the Church didn't genuinely and certainly require that the Judicame should be abolished, then that is disobedience to the Council. You think of those beautiful offertory prayers. Again, are we better Catholics? Is the Church a holier Church because they've all been abolished? What about the genuflection in the Creed? In this century, there's never been such a concerted attack upon the divinity of our Lord. And that genuflection was inserted into the Creed. It wasn't there originally, to show that people believe in the divinity of our Lord. Why was that abolished? What good has that done anybody? Again, with the last Gospel. That's one of the most inspiring passages in the entire Bible. And once again, it was a testimony to our belief in the divinity of our Lord. What good has that done anybody, abolishing the last Gospel? Then once you get down to the sanctuary, the smashing up of the altars, the tearing out of altar rails, often paid for, but literally by the pennies of the poor, how could that be demanded by the good of the Church? These are points I want to bring up when you're told by priests or bishops or liturgical experts, they say, you people are rebels, you're going against the Council. The people who did these things are going against the Council. There's one pamphlet of mine, it's called The Barbarians Have Taken Over, which was a quote actually from Archbishop Dwyer. He said, the barbarians have taken over the despisers of culture. And as a frontispiece in it, I have a picture of a cathedral in New Zealand. It was the centenary of the cathedral. And to celebrate the centenary, the bishop sent a bulldozer into the sanctuary to smash down the altar, which had been literally paid for by the pennies of poor Irish immigrants. And the astonishing thing was, he had a centenary appeal to commemorate the founding of the cathedral for people to give money to have the thing smashed up. Hamish Fraser, he said, that's one of the strangest things about what's happened since the Council, that the laity are asked to finance their own destruction. That's strange, but stranger still is about 90% of them pay up and do it. And I just can't understand how people who could remember in some places giving the money to build a church, giving the money to build a beautiful altar and sanctuary, then gave money to have it smashed down without batting an eyelid. Now, since I'm going to try not to go on too long to leave, you know, you've plenty of time to make observations or ask any questions, but I'll just give one other example of the way things have developed since the Council. Now, as I said, there's never been any official statement from the Church questioning the Eucharistic teaching of the Council of Trent in any way whatsoever. But in practice, these beliefs have been undermined. And the example I'll give you is reverence for the Blessed Sacrament. Now, if any of you had gone to any parish priest you knew before the Council or even after the Council and said, hey Father, hey Monsignor, let's abolish every single sign of reverence to the Blessed Sacrament, he would have probably thumped you or collapsed with a heart attack or thought you were crazy. But start thinking now about signs of reverence to the Blessed Sacrament. First of all, we knelt to receive the sacrament. Now, in most churches, it's received standing. Plates put on your chin by the altar boy to make sure that not the slightest fragment of the Blessed Sacrament could fall to the ground. That's very rarely used now. The Blessed Sacrament was placed on your tongue. Now it's very commonly placed in the hand. No one but a priest could touch the host. Now it's given out by bevies of extraordinary ministers. Actually, they call them now lay ministers. In every official publication of the Church, by the way, in canon law, they're called extraordinary ministers because they're only supposed to be used under extraordinary circumstances. And I can't think of any circumstances in a country like the United States or England where they could ever be justified if you really applied the norms laid down by the Vatican. But leave that aside. You get these bevies. Don't want to annoy it, seem of male chauvinists, but they usually seem to be ladies. No, I teach in a school where I'm the only male member of the staff. And I usually have a majority of girls in my class. That there is a kind of power tendency. See, you know, I've noted among some ladies, and they do seem to go for these jobs. But anyway, so you don't always receive it from the hands of a priest anymore. And then the sacred vessels in which the precious blood is contained, only a priest could touch those before. That was stated by the Council of Trent as a sign of reverence for the sacrament, that only a priest should touch the sacred vessels. Well, they're all carried up in these dreadful offertory processions now. So when you come down to it, every single sign of reverence to the Blessed Sacrament has either been abolished or made optional. But you see, it happened one sign at a time. And as I said, the priests who do it, who accept the situation now as quite normal, they really would have been horrified if you'd suggested to them that it should happen, or even that it might have happened. Now a word about the pastoral results of the council. As I said, I think the Missal of St. Pius V, the Bible apart, it really is our greatest treasure, and come what may, it should have been preserved. But if the new Missal had had wonderful pastoral results, if the lapsed Catholics had come pouring into the churches, and lukewarm Catholics had been filled with renewed faith, then you might have said, well, we've made a sacrifice, but the good for souls has amply justified it. But this hasn't happened at all. In every country throughout the West, there's been a dramatic collapse in mass attendance. In Holland, it's over 80%. In France, over 50% of those going to mass before the council no longer go. In Britain, over 30% no longer go. In the United States, about 30% of those who went before the council have stopped going. And so the new mass has brought actually no pastoral benefits whatsoever. So they can't say, well, you know, you don't care about the good of souls. You're interested in an archaeological preservation of liturgical curiosities. We're not. There haven't been any pastoral benefits from it. And that was what it was intended to produce. Now, what could we say is the final result of the reform of the liturgy, which the council said was intended to preserve and foster all the existing liturgies. I'll just read you another little quotation from the council. In faithful obedience to tradition, this most sacred council declares that Holy Mother Church holds all lawfully acknowledged rites to be of equal authority and dignity, and that she wishes to preserve them in the future and to foster them in every way. So, every liturgical rite within the Catholic Church, be it the Missal of St. Pius V, the Byzantine liturgy, all the rites had to be preserved and fostered with great care. Now, what is the final result? One man who should certainly know, it was a French Jesuit called Father Joseph Gallinau. He was one of the experts who helped with the composition of the new Mass and helped to impose it in France after the Council. Well, he says about the liturgical reform exactly what Father Ringrose would say, or exactly what Archbishop Lefebvre would say. He says the result has been the same, but he's glad. This is what he says, at least he's honest. Let those like myself who have known and sung a Latin Gregorian High Mass remember it if they can. That's rather sad, isn't it? Remember it if they can. Let them compare it with the Mass we now have. Not only the words, the melodies, and some of the gestures are different. To tell the truth, it is a different liturgy of the Mass. This needs to be said without ambiguity. The Roman Rite as we know it no longer exists. It has been destroyed. Now, I'd be very, very interested if any bishop or any liturgical expert could explain how you preserve and foster something by destroying it. But that, of course, sounds rather depressing, but the cheerful thing, of course, is that Father Gallinau is wrong, and the Roman Rite hasn't been destroyed. I don't know if any of you ever seen this little pantomime, the Tridentine Mass. It's just been redone for about the fifth time. It's got lots and lots of new material in it with some very nice pictures. It hasn't been too well printed, actually. They've got the index the wrong way around. It starts with M and goes to A, but there's a thing I don't even know anything about the Angelus Press, but it's all done by volunteer labour. No one gets paid in any way. I don't get paid providing them, and the people who typeset don't get paid for typesetting them. And it's printed by Father Carl, who's a Franciscan, and a French-Canadian brother called a Brother Lefebvre. You can tell Brother Lefebvre's productions, make sure this doesn't get back to him, because the ink is a variable quality. You'll find some pages are faded like this and others are quite good. But anyway, it's got a lot of material in it. And as a kind of introduction, I've quoted from an article by a man called Larry Henderson. Now, Larry Henderson was editor of the Catholic Register, which was the largest Catholic paper in Canada. And he's now given that up and started a kind of a publication that's halfway between a conservative and traditional publication, somewhere between halfway between the Wanderer and the Remnant. And he went to his first Tridentine Mass a few years ago. I was surprised that I wrote to him, because I said I hadn't realized you were so young, because I know Hamish Fraser greatly admired this man, Larry Henderson. Actually, he isn't young, he was a convert, and he became a Catholic quite late in his life, but he was a professional journalist, and the Canadian bishops were glad for him to take over the Catholic Register. So he didn't go until after this Indult came out, which I think was in 1984. So out of curiosity, he went to see what the Tridentine Mass was, because lots of his readers used to write in and say they'd like to have the Tridentine Mass. And he said, this is what he says: "I attended a Tridentine Mass at St. Mary's Cathedral in Hamilton on the first Sunday of this month, and I found it a very significant experience. The whole subject of the Tridentine Mass is surrounded by so much obfuscation that I may be able to throw some light on it. You see, I never had attended a Tridentine Mass before. Thus, I have no commitment to childhood memories, no gut feelings for Latin, no predisposition for the old rather than the new. I am able to discover, just as many, very many, young people did at Hamilton. What I found was something quite extraordinary by contemporary standards, a mass of extreme intensity, focused on the Eucharist and filled with an awareness of the action of salvation through the sacraments. Now, I do not for a moment suggest that other masses do not contain these elements. Every mass has its salvific effect. But the Tridentine Mass brought me a dimension which is distinctly missing today, a sense of awe and wonder at the glory of God, the littleness of man, and the need for divine mercy. In the packed chapel, the act of worship resumed its ancient function, that of saving souls. Many knew their Latin and read it from long unused yellow missals. To say the experience was spine-tingling is putting it mildly. This experience is something entirely distinct from antiquarianism. The idea that the Tridentine appeals only to Latinists and scholars vanished before the sight of these rows and rows of intent faces, many careworn and bedewed with tears, workmen's hands through which the rosary was slipping, young fathers everywhere holding up their smallest children to see the host. This is a religion which will not fail. It has gone underground for many years. It has been overlaid with contemporary concerns. But this kind of religion is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. And that is how many people about it, far more than is allowed for in contemporary philosophy." And Mr. Henderson goes on to term the Tridentine Mass the Mass that will not die. And the Tridentine Mass will not die because the ordinary faithful will not allow it to. The movement to preserve and restore the Tridentine Mass, somewhat ironic, but it's really, I think, the only genuine grassroots movement which has emerged since the Council. The liturgical revolution, which was aimed at destroying the Tridentine Mass, that's being imposed from above by a clerical bureaucracy using money that they've extorted from the faithful. But the movement to preserve the Tridentine Mass, as you all know, it's emerged spontaneously among the faithful, and it's been sustained by their freely offered sacrifices. And there's a very interesting phrase, little sentence that Dietrich von Hildebrand said about the Tridentine Mass and the liturgical reform, which I think the ordinary faithful, like von Hildebrand, they appreciate that this is true. Because As von Hildebrand says in this quotation I'm going to read you, the idea that people today could concoct a liturgy that was superior to one that had been built up over 1500 years by saints, it is scarcely credible arrogance. This is what von Hildebrand said. The new liturgy was simply not formed by saints and artistically gifted men, but has been worked out by so-called experts who are not at all aware that in our time there is a distinct lack of talent for such things. Today is a time of incredible talent for technology and medical research, but not for the organic shaping of the expression of the religious world. We live in a world without poetry, and this means that one should approach the treasures handed on from more fortunate times with twice as much reverence, and not with the illusion that we can do it better ourselves. The new liturgy is without splendor, flattened and undifferentiated. Truly, if one of the devils in C.S. Lewis, the Screwtape Letters, had been entrusted with the ruin of the liturgy, he could not have done it better. And I think we'll all agree with von Hildebrand there, and it's very encouraging for people like ourselves that someone of his intellect feels the same way that we do, because we're often told by the Church of Experts that we're very ignorant and very uneducated and we don't understand these things. But the average liturgical expert compared with von Hildebrand is an intellectual and spiritual and liturgical pygmy. And I'm sure we'd agree if you've got all the liturgical experts in the world and closeted them together, what I've heard of some of them, that might be a very appropriate term as well, but still. And they spent years together working day and night. I'm sure we'd agree they couldn't improve upon the Tridentine Mass, because it really is, as Father Faber said it, it's the most beautiful thing this side of heaven. And it's a foretaste of the heavenly bliss. While we're still on earth, we can, as it were, participate in heaven. And this is what Father Faber said about the Tridentine Mass, continuing on from saying that it is the most beautiful thing this side of heaven. It came forth, he said, from the grand mind of the Church, and lifted us out of earth and out of self, and wrapped us round in a cloud of mystical sweetness and the sublimities of a more than angelic liturgy, and purified us almost without ourselves, and charmed us with celestial charming, so that our very senses seemed to find vision, hearing, fragrance, taste, and touch beyond what earth can give. Well, I think very few people could say that about the new Mass. Now, for many years following the Council, I was very, very depressed about the disintegration of post-conciliar Catholicism, because I was a convert and I'd only just become a Catholic just before the Council, and everything that inspired me so much began to be thrown out. And I could see, as Pope Paul VI admitted, the Church was undergoing a process of self-destruction. It's just unbelievable. No one from outside the Church was destroying it. It was being destroyed from within. And sometimes I seriously used to think how wonderful it would have been to have been born perhaps 50 years before and to have died just at the beginning of the Second Vatican Council. Because at that time, most people thought it was a sign of great hope and a great renewal and a great flowering, and we were going to a wonderful new era. Now, I stopped thinking that. It was a result, actually, of a letter from a lady. When ladies put me right, I'm always honest enough to admit it. That's part of what being a man is all about. We own up when we're wrong. And I'm writing a book. It probably won't come out for a number of years. It's called Victims of the Revolution, and it's all about priests who've been thrown out of their parishes, not necessarily for saying the Tridentine Mass. If any of you have read that book of mine, The Barbarians Have Taken Over, you'll have read about Monsignor Carney in Kansas City. Has anybody heard of Monsignor Carney? He was a pastor, priest of a parish called Parish of Christ the King. He wasn't a traditionalist, but he said the new Mass, strictly according to the rubrics, you have no sign of peace, because you don't have to have a sign of peace. No extraordinary ministers. He still had his tabernacle on the altar. and he gave very good sermons, and his congregation went up to about 5,000 every Sunday, just happened to put on extra masses. And people complained to Bishop Sullivan, so he just phoned up Monsignor Carney and said, "You're sacked." That was his thanks for about 30 years of service in the diocese. He was a very silly man because he packed up and left his presbytery. And once that had happened, that was the end of it. He went to Rome to complain, but of course nothing happened. And they sent in the auxiliary bishop to take over as the pastor. You see, he had to sort of bring these people into the post-conciliar era. And he said he was going to give a series of talks because he didn't think Monsignor Carney had really given the full story. And he said to them, "I haven't come here to change anything at all, but if when I've explained about the changes to you, you would like the things changed, then we'll do it. But it's entirely up to you." And the first thing he gave a talk about was the tabernacle, because it was really, I think as you said, it was really bugging him and Bishop Sullivan, this tabernacle, because it was the only one in the diocese still on the main altar. So he explained to them why the tabernacle should be removed from the altar, and then asked for comments. Actually, I think one person there read him a whole chapter from my book, Pope Paul's New Mass. I've got a whole chapter about the tabernacle and the altar, so he must have been terribly bored by that. But anyway, they had a vote on it, and I think it was over 99% of the people voted to keep the tabernacle on the altar. And he said, "Very well, I will respect your wishes." But a few days later, there was a little girl in the parish school, and she saw some workmen going into the school. And again, I have to praise, you know, female initiative here. An American, no English schoolgirl would have done this. She snuck out of school. That's a good American word I've used. She snuck out of school and went home, and she said, "Mummy," or "Mommy," "Mom," I think you say already. She said, "I think there's something funny going on in the church." So her mother went round and she said, she saw some workmen in there, and she said, "What's going on?" They said, "Oh, we're taking this tabernacle off the altar, and they're building a little brick plinth. We're going to put it on the side." So this lady, again, I've got to, you know, pay tribute to ladies, especially American ladies, because British ladies wouldn't have done this at all. She rung up three or four of her friends, and they all sat down in front of the altar and held hands. And they said, if you touch one of us, we're going to sue you for assault. So the workmen walked out. They said they weren't going to do this. And so this went on every day. The ladies came in by day, and at night men took in turns to go around the church in their cars because they didn't trust the bishop at all. And they arrived one morning. The ladies arrived to find armed police outside the church, and he'd got a court order from a judge. And that any parishioner who went inside their own parish church, and I've always remembered this because I think you could make a country song up about it, they were going to get 120 days in the Jackson County Jail. And, you know, you'd love to hear someone like Johnny Cash, you're starting, he done said, "I'll go to the Jackson County Jail." So you just imagine that if you go in your parish church, you're going to be in the jail for 120 days. Then, of course, he got the tabernacle off the altar. And so, but it's great irony because you see, God works in mysterious ways, his wonders to perform, and I think he writes straight with crooked lines. But the very day that he got this tabernacle off the last altar in his whole diocese, where it was on the altar, Archbishop Lefebvre came and consecrated the Church of St. Vincent's in Kansas City, which they bought. And of course, they've got a beautiful tabernacle on the altar there. And a lot of parishioners, they said to Monsignor Carney, "What do you think? Can we go to that?" And he advised them all to go there. So they have one of the largest traditional congregations of the whole of the United States in St. Vincent's in Kansas City, which is all entirely due to the bishop, which certainly bears thinking about. But, which I'm afraid I've digressed greatly from the point I was trying to make, which was the letter I received from a lady who when I had mentioned the remnant, I was writing this book, and I'd like our priests like Monsignor Carney, who'd been forced out of their parishes, and teachers who'd been sacked from their schools, nuns who'd been persecuted in their convents, to get in touch with me, because I was going to write a book called Victims of the Revolution. This lady wrote to me and said, "You've got it all wrong. See, those people aren't the victims of the revolution at all. They're actually the survivors, they're the victors." And she pointed out quite correctly, during the time of the Reformation in England, it was the priests who went up onto the scaffold, who had the rope around their neck, who were going to be hung, drawn, and quartered, They actually were the victors, and it was the priests who'd abandoned the Catholic faith in which they really believed in their hearts and agreed to celebrate the Protestant communion service. They were the victims of the revolution. And in this country, I think you can say the real victim of the revolution is the basically Orthodox Monsignor. I'm sure you all know someone of this type, who received a very sound seminary formation, who offered the Tridentine Mass for many years, who never thought that it should be changed in any way or ever could be changed in any way. But today you'll see him sitting in his sanctuary, or what remains of his sanctuary after he's had it all smashed up, without the least trace of regret. And you'll see him sitting there in his presidential chair, tapping his feet and grinning inanely, because you have to grin all the way through the new liturgy. You'll see him grinning inanely while guitars twang away and they play music of incredible banality, and perhaps you have dancing girls cavorting about, swarms of these lady extraordinary ministers rushing about, and month by month his congregation declines. And some of you might know there's a directive being put out by the American bishops. The parish priests have got to cut down the number of Sunday masses to cover up the declining congregation. So it still appears in quite a few parishes that they still have good congregation, but it might be where they had five masses on a Sunday morning, now they only have two. And also this Monsignor, he'll know that the children in his parish school are not being taught their faith at all. This is more or less universal throughout the Western world. In the deanery where I teach, they had a survey on children in Catholic schools. They surveyed about several thousand of them, and they found that only 2% of them, they said, had any knowledge of their faith whatsoever, and the other 98% were likely to lapse within a year of leaving school. Think of that, 98% of Catholic children likely to lapse, and this was the official deanery survey. I mentioned Mrs. Muxhardt, I was quite pleased because my class was in that survey and it formed exactly 2%, the total. And some of the answers, even these liberal priests were horrified. Well, one example, they gave all these examples of answers. One of the questions was, what are the seven sacraments? And the child put, God gave them to Moses on the top of Mount Everest. But most of the children just put a blank, they didn't know. So that was one of the better answers. But that, of course, I don't know. If anyone here hasn't read 1984, you ought to read it, and you learn all about this newspeak. But this is part of the newspeak of Vatican II. You see, you have a renewal of religious education, and it ends up with the children knowing nothing. You have a renewal of seminary education, the seminaries are empty. You have a renewal of the religious life, and the convents empty and closed down. They're closing down school after school after school and selling them to groups like the Moonies. But I said this Monsignor will know that in his parochial school, the children, if they're lucky, they'll be learning nothing. If they're not lucky, they'll be learning heresy. And they might be having their morals corrupted with deplorable sex education programs. They'll just pretend he doesn't know anything about it. He'll just go out and play his round of golf two or three times in the week and just ignore what's going on. And week after week, or day after day, he'll sit in his sanctuary, as I said, and just endure what's going on. He's probably not a malicious man at heart, and probably in recent weeks he's probably felt a few pangs of compassion for that French fellow, that Paul Lefebvre fellow, and he'll be saying to himself, well, he just couldn't adapt. But when you think about it, who really merits our compassion at the moment, this typical Monsignor or Archbishop Lefebvre, who is the victim? And that's why since that lady wrote to me, I've been a lot more cheerful. I think now that it's a great privilege for us to live in these times. This is certainly the worst time for the church since the Arian heresy. And it's a great privilege for us to live in these times and to be able to play our own small part, perhaps in helping to salvage something from the ruins of the post-conciliar debacle. Now, I want to close, you'll be glad to know, with a little quotation. St. Athanasius, who, as you know, he sustained a faithful remnant of true Catholics during the Arian heresy, and he addressed some words to them, which I think apply to every one of us, and we don't have to change one word. This is what St. Athanasius said. The church has not just recently been given order and statutes. They were faithfully and soundly bestowed upon it by the fathers. Nor has the faith only just been established, but it has come to us from the Lord through his disciples. May what has been preserved in the churches from the beginning to the present day not be abandoned in our time. May what has been entrusted into our keeping not be embezzled by us. Brethren, as custodians of God's mysteries, let yourselves be roused into action on seeing all this despoiled by others. I hope very much that we all have been aroused to action and that we will continue acting. And I apologize if I went on longer than I thought I was going to. It's 2 o'clock in the morning now. So, to make any comments or ask anything about anything. I don't really mind. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. I don't mind how long I stay. So. Yes, sir.
Well, you mentioned that a lot of the changes in the new mass are in the direction of Protestantism, and this is true. But it occurs to me that some of the changes go beyond Protestantism to some extent, or are simultaneous with the same change among Protestants. For instance, I was never at an Anglican service where it wasn't common to genuflect during the creed. And another change.
Well, that would be among Anglo-Catholics.
Let me say I went to all sorts of Anglican services in this country and in England for a number of years, since throughout my childhood and part of my adulthood.
Yeah.
And I never was at one where no one did.
Yeah. I used to be an Anglican choir boy, and we never genuflected. Do you have it over here what we have called low church and high church?
Oh, sure.
And the low church Anglicans, I'm sure, never genuflected.
They tend toward the Methodist in no form.
But they might have over here.
But another one is the use now of a strange translation of credo, namely we believe.
Yeah, yes.
Which occurs among Swedish Lutherans and Catholics in this country and begins to occur among Protestants.
Well, that actually, you see, where the translations come, there are two different bodies. There's the ICEL, which in theory is supposed to be a Catholic body. I think it's the International Commission for English and the Liturgy. And then there's ICET, which is the International Commission for English Texts. And that is a Protestant body. But what the Catholic bishops have decided to do for ecumenical reasons is where we have any common text in the liturgy, where you have something like the Gloria, or the Creed, or the Our Father, they've decided to incorporate these ICE texts into the ICEL text. So that we will have the same, we will say the same prayers and the same words as the Protestants. Well, I think in this country, though, they haven't adopted the new Protestant version of the Lord's Prayer, have they? About do not put us to the test.
No, they
haven't in England, but in most English-speaking countries, they've adopted that now.
Well, how about the interesting phenomenon, though, that in the words of consecration, there's an unusual translation for multis.
Yeah, that's not with the Protestants, because all the Protestants are safe for many.
Why is it that all the vulgar languages use this strange translation? And is there any justification for it linguistically?
No, it's that this thing about having for all men, well, they have it for all now because they found out, they didn't know at the time that was sexist saying for all men. But that is, you can't find any ecumenical reason for that at all, because every Protestant communion service has for many. And every liturgy throughout the whole world, all the Orthodox liturgies, all the Catholic Eastern liturgies, they all have for many. And there isn't any, there definitely is no linguistic justification for saying for all men at all. There are cases where the Greek word for many sometimes means all. They said that our Lord gave himself as a ransom for many. He gave himself as a ransom for all men. And there places in the Bible where it could mean, sometimes it could mean all, and sometimes it could mean many. But the point is, when a phrase has been used in the Catholic liturgy for thousands of years in a particular sense, that in a way codifies it and makes it sacrosanct, and it shouldn't be changed. And what the justification they gave from it, they said every time this word is used in the scriptures, it means for all men, which was absolutely untrue. And that appeared, there was the official magazine of Archbishop Unini's concilium was called Notitiae, and they put an article in that by a supposed scholar who said this. But they then had to retract it in 2 months' time, because lots of scripture scholars who weren't even necessarily conservative just wrote in to say what utter nonsense this was. And they gave many examples of passages in the Bible where the word was used meaning many. It is actually somewhat more complex than that, you see, because in Aramaic and Hebrew, the word actually is more like our word multitude, and so if you use it as many, you could say I was giving a party and I invited all my friends and many came. They say the multitude came. Now it could mean the whole lot came, or it could mean only some came. If we say many came, it excludes, it means the whole lot definitely didn't. But there's a very good friend of mine, Professor van der Ploeg, who's probably the greatest scholar of Hebrew and Aramaic in the Catholic Church in Europe today. And I've quoted him actually in my book Paul's New Mass. And he said there's absolutely no justification whatsoever for changing these words. And why they did it, nobody knows. There definitely was a concerted campaign to do this, because it couldn't be a coincidence that exactly the same linguistic mistake occurred in about 8 languages. Even my wife's a Croatian, and even in Croatian it came out for all men. In Spanish, French actually, they say pour la multitude, for the multitude. They're one of the few languages where it hasn't happened. But of course, it's a totally different question as to whether that it affects the validity of the Mass. And Father van der Ploeg says he thinks it definitely doesn't affect the validity of the consecration, because the essential words for the consecration, just this is my body and this is my blood. I've checked this up, I think I've looked it up in about 20 reference books, and there's only one actually that says any of the other words are essential for validity. So the only way it could affect validity is if the priest who is using it deliberately said this word for all men, meaning by this that he thought everybody was going to be saved. And I think the typical parish priest, he just says whatever they put down, he just says it. He doesn't read anything into it. In fact, most of them today, they wouldn't think about any theological implications at all. But it was absolutely unjustified, and the silly state they've got themselves into can be seen by the fact that they've now had to change it to for all. Yes, sir.
Can you tell us what the rationale is behind the con celebration? And what value is it?
Well, this meant the theology of concelebration. It's something rather above my head. It's very, very complex, because you see, it can't be condemned theologically, because at the ordination mass, all the new priests concelebrate with the bishop, and every one of them is allowed to receive a stipend. An individual stipend, so you might have 20 new priests all kind of celebrating the same Mass, and they've always been allowed to receive a stipend. And in the Eastern Church, concelebration is the normal form. But then on the other hand, you see, it's a point Archbishop Lefebvre, he's very much against this new vote for concelebration, because he says in a Mass you only have one consecration, so that you only get the fruit from one Mass. So if 20 priests sang one Mass, you'd get the same fruits from 20 priests saying 20 separate Masses. What is the point if you have a special intention of having 20 Masses said? If the fruits from one Mass can celebrated, it would be the same as the fruits if 20 priests said it individually. So it is a slightly complex problem. Why they do why they do this all the time, the priests can celebrate all the time today, I just don't know. Because in a way it doesn't really save them time. Because lots of things the priests do today, because it saves them time, I suppose, so they can get out and play golf. But that's why the canon number 2 is the most popular one. It's because it's short. But you know, lots of priest retreats now, most of them, they all can celebrate. I had a very good friend of mine, Father Paul Crane, some of you might have seen Christian Order, and when he goes to the Jesuit retreats, he refuses to come celebrate. But he's the only one who says his own private mass. Because he feels if someone has given him a stipend, he should say the mass just for that person and that person's intention.
There was 20 priests. Is that 20 masses or just one mass?
Yeah, well, it is just one mass.
Well, if each priest says a separate mass, there's 20 masses.
Yeah, there are 20 masses.
So then the efficacy is 20 times one mass.
Yes, that. Well, actually, I suppose you can't really work this out in a kind of mathematical ratio.
I don't mean that, but the point is that it behooves a priest to say a mass every day rather than consult.
Yes.
Well, the reason I bring this up is that I go up here to Berryville to the Trappist Monastery, and they have about 12 priests, and they all consolidate every day.
Well, I hope also their masses are valid, because I know in one Trappist Monastery, I had a friend who was a priest there, He had got permission to become, even with jet lag, I think I'm getting it, exclaustrated. But he had to go back and spend one night there each year. And he went back one year, and there's one of the brothers was making the older breads. He said, oh, come along and see the new recipe we're using. And he was horrified, because this meant that masses were totally invalid. They were putting milk and... Is there something you have over here called Crisco or something like that? Something they're putting all these things in it. And all the priests, there are quite a number of priests in this monastery, and they're all celebrating every day, and every one of them was taking a stipend. I think there were something like 50 priests in this monastery. So that was, they were saying 50 invalid masses every day, celebrated or not, and taking stipends for that. Whether they changed it, I don't know. So I think if one's going to have a mass said, it's better to find a priest one knows is going to use the correct matter and correct form, and will say an individual mass for you. And if you ask a priest to say an individual mass for you, he has to agree to that. If he doesn't want to, if he wants to concelebrate, he can say so. But if he's agreed that he will say an individual mass for you, he has to say it. I know I certainly would, if I was having masses said for any purpose, I would always want individual masses said. But as I said, it is a slightly, that is something that's above my head, and I've never done a lot of research on that. I don't know if Father Ringrose would like to say anything about that.
Well, I haven't done any scientific research on it, but I know at my time in the Novus Ordo, I was in the same spot as Father Crane, and I refused to concelebrate under any circumstances. I think one of the reasons they push it is that to them the Mass is supposed to be a big, happy community meal. And if you're going off and doing it by yourself, then you're not joining the big happy community, you see.
But then on the other hand, the fact that it has always been the practice of the Eastern Rites, it means that in itself, you can't really be reprehensible. And as I said, you've got this problem that in ordinations, all the newly ordained priests are allowed to concelebrate with the bishop and all accept a stipend. So that is something I wouldn't make a big issue about. Something like smashing up your altar and putting a table there, that's something you can prove that is wrong and contrary to tradition and not mandated by Vatican II. But the concelebration issue is something on which there are two sides to the question. There's a huge book being written about it by a French priest who Hamish called Père Joseph de Saint-Marie. You will have heard of him. Hamish Fraser was always quoting him in approaches, and he said it is definitely unacceptable, and he said it's definitely not the same value having 20 priests celebrate one mass as 20 priests celebrate separate masses. But of course that was just his opinion as a theologian. The church has never pronounced upon that. So it isn't something you could accuse someone of unorthodoxy for concelebrating. Yes, sir.
I'll ask the big question. What's the situation with Archbishop of Bethesda.
I
read in The Wanderer where you're about to publish a position paper.
Oh, no, that's very interesting, because somebody from the Angelus rang me up from the Angelus in great alarm. They said, because people have been ringing up, cancelling my book Apologia 3, because they read in The Wanderer, and that I turned against Archbishop of Fervor in an interview with The Wanderer. But I've never actually ever spoken to any. No one from The Wanderer has ever written to me, or phoned me, or spoken to me. And I've never seen this thing in
That's
the...
That's it right there.
Yeah, I've never seen this thing in The Wanderer. So how they could know that, I don't know. Well, what actually is happening when you, those of you get the remnant, in the next remnant, I've done a very detailed kind of blow-by-blow account of that every single thing that's happened in this entire business. Actually, I've gone right back to, right from the foundation of the society and given a resume of the whole history. If you like giving it to you, you know, as quickly as I can from memory, I could get a copy of it out, but I'd probably talk too long then. What really, the present business really started in January 1987 when there's a magazine called 30 Days, printed jointly in Italian, and the Archbishop was interviewed by it, and he said he was thinking of consecrating a number of bishops. He repeated that in the ordination sermon in 1987, and this really put the Vatican in a panic, and he was invited to Rome to see Cardinal Ratzinger. Cardinal Ratzinger said, we don't want you to do this, so something must be done about this, and we really will see if we can reach some sort of agreement. And he said, so the Archbishop had always asked, he's been asking for years now, he wanted an apostolic visitor sent to the seminary and all the houses of the society, just to see, so people can see what they're doing, and form a judgment as to whether he should be recognized again on the basis of what is going on. Well, they said they would send an apostolic visitor, but they wanted him to give certain powers to this apostolic visitor, so he would really, you know, be taking over the society. So the Archbishop said he wouldn't agree to that. And then the Vatican backed down, and they said, right, they'd just send one for fact-finding. And it was going to be very significant who they chose. And they chose, if the Archbishop and everyone in the society could have chosen someone, they'd have chosen Cardinal Gagnon, because he is totally sympathetic to the society, so they were really delighted when that happened. He said to Archbishop one day, he said, Monsignor, so I keep getting a terrible temptation. And the Archbishop said, what's that, Your Eminence? He said, I keep feeling I ought to join your fraternity. anyway, they sent Cardinal Gagnon and Monsignor Perel, they sent him to visit, they just didn't just visit the society establishments, they visited lots of the other religious orders that have grown up in Europe. I find a lot of people over here don't know about these, but they've got several groups of Benedictines, particularly the ones at Le Barreau and Dom Gérard. That's really amazed people in France. Paris Match did about half an issue. That's like, I think, the equivalent of Time magazine, Paris Match, on this monastery at Le Barreau, which is amazing. It's just like Écône. They started from scratch, just a couple of people, and they've had novices come there all from all over the world. Now they've built a beautiful monastery. If you ever go to Europe, especially if you want to go for a Holy Week, it will make you think you've arrived in heaven. You can go there to Le Barreau. You can hire campers and things over there because all the hotels are booked up. But it's a wonderful thing to do. They have wonderful order of Dominican nuns, a place called Le Fongeau, quite a few English traditionalists and their daughters there now. If any of you are affluent, think your daughters might like it. It's a wonderful education for them, and of course they end up speaking French perfectly, which would be a great help to them. And of course, some children, if you send them away to a boarding school, they're very, very unhappy, especially if they go into a different kind of cultural ethos. So in some ways it might not be a good idea, but if you had a daughter who could adapt to that, they'd probably do well from it. But that's very successful. And they've got Franciscans, all sorts of religious orders. Well, Cardinal Gagnon went round to visit all these, and he was very, very impressed by everything he saw. And actually, he described, when he went to Écône, he described Archbishop Lefebvre to the seminary, and he said, Archbishop Lefebvre is a great treasure given to the church by God. And he took part, in theory, you see, the Archbishop is suspended ad divinis. That means from sacred things. He's not supposed to say Mass or hear confession. And yet he was bestowing minor orders on some of his seminarians, and Cardinal Gagnon officiated in the ceremony as a participant, which the Archbishop said he found quite amusing in a way that here he was not supposed to be doing this, and here was the Cardinal taking part. Anyway, the Cardinal, he went back to Rome and gave his report to the Pope. And then the Archbishop, quite understandably, began to get very impatient because months went by and they didn't hear anything from it. So he said, right, I've had enough of this. I'm going to go ahead in June. I'm going to consecrate three bishops. He later changed it to four. So once again, Karl Ratzinger says, no, don't do that, because something is going to be done. And then he said, send along from your society, send along a theologian and a canonist, and they can get together with a theologian and canonist that I'll appoint, and I'll also appoint a moderator, and we'll work out an agreement. Well, they got together and worked out an agreement, and it took a lot of very hard bargaining, but in the end, an agreement was worked out that was satisfactory to both sides. Then when that was done, and the four theologians, or the two theologians, the two canonists, they initialed this agreement, then Archbishop Lefebvre got together with Cardinal Ratzinger, and they went through it literally word by word till they were satisfied, and they both signed it. And did you actually read it today, Father? I gave, or if you didn't have time, perhaps.
No, I haven't had time.
But I gave Father Ringworth a copy of the agreement, and I think it was a very, very good agreement. Everything the Archbishop has been asking for all these years, he was given every single thing he'd asked. And lots of things he was supposed to do, like certain statements about the new Mass the Vatican had always insisted he should make, those were removed. Actually, Father Linnaeus told me, when he went in for the first time with Cardinal Ratzinger and looked at it, there was a part where he had to promise he wouldn't criticize the new Mass anymore. And they were reading it through, and apparently he didn't say a word, he just looked at it like that and stopped for about a minute and looked at Cardinal Ratzinger, and Cardinal Ratzinger looked at him. Then he went on through it. When he came back the next day, that passage had been taken out. And they agreed that he could consecrate one bishop chosen from the society. But you see, they wouldn't give a date on it. And then the next day, which I'm puzzled by, he says it's due to an inspiration from Our Lady, but it disturbed me. He changed his mind. And one reason, it was a legitimate one, they wouldn't give a date for the consecration of this bishop, and they kept prevaricating. You see, the agreement was signed on May the 5th. Eventually, on the 30th of May, they gave a definite date for the consecration of the bishop, which was to be August the 15th. And they've been exchanging letters. And the Archbishop then, he wanted to have three bishops, but the Vatican was adamant on that. But again, so my sympathy here is with the Vatican, you see, because up to a couple of years ago, he hadn't even been asking for one bishop as a condition of reconciliation. If you read his book, An Open Letter to Confused Catholics, which is an excellent book, it's well worth getting, he's got one coming out, Don't Tell the Angels I Told You This, called They Have Uncrowned Him, but you'll find it's almost that unintelligible. It's all about religious liberty and things like that. It's not easy reading. Like his book, J'accuse Le Conseil, I Accuse the Council, that's not easy reading. His two books everyone ought to have are An Open Letter to Confused Catholics and A Bishop Speaks. They're both very well written books and written very simply and straightforward. But at the end of An Open Letter to Confused Catholics, which only was published a couple of years ago, he said, people often ask me, what will happen if you die without a successor? And he said, that doesn't trouble me at all, because I've got complete faith in divine providence. So I'm sure that bishops will arise. Anyway, that changed this May, so he wanted to have three or even four bishops. But anyway, it was agreed upon he could have a bishop chosen from the society. Well, the first three names he put in, the Vatican turned down. But there's nothing really sinister about that. Those of you who read The Remnant, I think it was this year or last year, I wrote about the new Archbishop of Dublin. And when you're going to have a bishop, you submit three names. It's called a turner. And the Pope turned down the first two lots of three names for the Archdiocese of Dublin. He threw out the whole six because he thought they were too liberal until he got one who's reasonably conservative. I suppose by conservative, maybe he believes in a life force, like that. Anyway, so I don't think there's necessarily anything sinister about the fact that they turned down the first three names, but they guaranteed to him that they would accelerate the process for choosing a bishop, and he definitely could consecrate one on August the 15th. But by then, he totally, you know, made up his mind that he was going to go ahead and consecrate these four bishops on June the 30th. Some people think now that he's now in a stronger bargaining position than ever, providing, you know, most of the society priests stand firm and remain with him. And he said he thinks within 3 or 4 years there will be a reconciliation with the Vatican. And Cardinal Ratzinger made a speech a couple of weeks ago. He said this is by no means the end of the story. And actually he admitted that on most of the points he'd been making, Archbishop Lefebvre was right, that he had been opposing modernism, and the church is in a terrible state. So I don't think by any means all hope of a reconciliation is lost. But my view, having seen all the documents, and you'll see a synopsis of them all in the next remnant, I would have preferred that he'd accepted the agreement. You see, he says he doesn't trust the Vatican. And it's quite possible he had good reason not to trust the Vatican. But as he had a written agreement, if the Vatican had broken it, he could have said, right, you've broken the agreement, and now I withdraw from it. Perhaps it's for malicious reasons I wish he had accepted it, because I can't help thinking, on my particular bet, no, as Cardinal Hume in Westminster, who's the biggest creep you've ever seen, I prefer people like Wieglin and Hunthausen to him, because at least they're out-and-out modernists. And, you know, how he would have felt this August the 15th, if Archbishop Lefebvre had consecrated a bishop and the society had been recognized and his suspension had been lifted and it was all official, even if that had only lasted for 1 month. Probably every bishop in the world, they'd have probably been dropping dead with heart attacks and jumping off the spires of their cathedrals. It would have been lovely just to think of them frothing at the mouth. But now you see that what they're saying now, you see, again from the best of public relations point of view, they're saying that the Archbishop signed this document and he went back on his word. You see, he's saying, well, he didn't trust them. He thinks they'd have used it to undermine the society. But in that case, you see, he shouldn't have signed the thing in the first place. So, you know, I rather regret that he didn't keep to this agreement, accept the recognition, see what happened. Because, as I said, he could have just withdrawn from it the moment they broke the agreement. Oh, and what has happened since? A group of priests from the society have left it now, and the Pope has set up a commission headed by a Cardinal Mayor. And I was showing it to Father Ringrose today. He's put out a motu proprio, which is a document of very great authority, and he's set up this commission for traditional Catholics, which was part of the agreement with Archbishop Lefebvre. And he's also said he wants the needs of people like ourselves, they definitely have to be catered to. But whether the bishops will take any notice of that, I don't know. I'll just say a couple words about this commission, because this is one thing you'll see in the society publications. They're saying, you see, the Archbishop, there are 5 members on it. He wanted all 5 of them to be from the society. And the Pope said, now, 2 can be from the society and 3 will be from the Vatican. Well, he said, well, that means the Vatican will have majority. But in a way, that's irrelevant, because in all the Roman commissions, in the end, the Pope has the last word. So if you'd had 5 society priests and they'd proposed something that the Pope didn't agree with, it wouldn't have made any difference. And they would have, you see, the society's had no voice in the Vatican at all up to now. So having 2 members on this commission, in a way, would be a big step forward. And again, something I don't like, several society priests have said, well, it was 2 society priests and 3 modernists. So I think you have to be, although you've defended the Archbishop all these years and supported the society, but you've got to be objective about these things. So I've said to them, I said, well, what are the names of these theologians? None of them even know their names. I said, well, how do you know they're modernists? And I found out the 3 names of them, and as far as I can see, they're all very orthodox people, like Father Michelli. So I've told some of them the names of them. I said, well, tell me, if you're going to say someone's a modernist, we don't like people who've been attacking Archbishop Lefebvre and attacked traditional priests unfairly. If you're going to accuse someone of being a modernist, you've got to substantiate it. So I said, do you know anything they've said or anything they've written that isn't orthodox? So of course, they didn't. So that, I think, is a mistake traditionalists must avoid, to try and divide people into, priests say the traditional mass and people who go to it, and the modernists. You know, the wanderer doesn't like me, but you know, the wanderer readers, they're orthodox Catholics. They're just the same as we are. What their mistake is, they won't face up to the full implications of liturgical reform. But it doesn't alter the fact that they're, you know, they're still basically orthodox Catholics. Anyway, getting back to this, you know, these consecrations. So the Archbishop then, he decided, he'd just go ahead with it. And again, he said, well, everything he'd achieved was only when he threatened to consecrate bishops, which is absolutely true. But again, you see, he knew that when he signed the agreement. And it has puzzled me because, you know, I've got all the documents, lots of them haven't been published. If anyone's hoping this Apologia III I've written, you're going to read all about it there, you won't, because it only goes up to the end of 1982. I'm already two-thirds of the way through Apologia IV, which would take it up to about 1986. So all the story of these consecrations, that would be in Apologia V, unless I've dropped dead before then. It just goes on and on and on. I never even wanted it. It was just a pure accident that I started it, because, you know, my ancestry, I'm Welsh by ancestry, and the Celts, you know, the Welsh like the Irish, we sometimes get very melodramatic, especially if we had a drink or two. And I read, how I started with this, I read there was a dreadful attack on the Archbishop of Fervor by a man who's the spokesman for our hierarchy, for the Catholic Information Office. And he said things that are absolutely untrue, so I wrote to him and said, these things, you know, you've written about Archbishop of Fervor are absolutely untrue, you don't have to approve him. You can't write things that aren't correct. Yes, because in English you have a concept of it's not cricket. You don't have that concept over here, do you? You don't say it's not baseball or anything. Because I believe it's considered part of the game to do sneaky things in baseball, isn't it? If you can. But anyway, in cricket, you're not supposed to do anything that isn't, you're absolutely fair and above board. So he wrote a very rude letter back to me. He said, I'm a Monsignor, I've been a priest for 25 years, you're just a layman. You know, how dare you tell me I've made mistakes? So I wrote back to begin a very polite letter. I said, but Monsignor, you're the person who's made these accusations, and you've said, he said, for instance, Archbishop of Fervor was actively involved in the movement called the Action Française, which actually wasn't a fascist movement at all, but it generally is taken as being. I said, the whole time the Action Française movement was taking place, he was in Africa as a missionary, and he's been asked about it, and he said he never met this man Charles Morin who founded it, he's never read his once read his paper, he's never read any of his books, he's never met him, he's never had any connection with it at all. So he wrote back to me, and he said, I have sources of information to which you do not have access. So I said, well, why don't you publish them? He said, I don't have to justify myself to you. So what I did, you see, he'd written a little pamphlet about Archbishop of Fervor, so I wrote back one, almost a facsimile of this Monsignor's pamphlet. I called it Archbishop of Fervor, the Truth. I don't know if anyone here ever saw it. You've seen it. That surprises me. And but you've never seen the original. If you give me your address, I'll send you the original, the one Monsignor Leonard did. And mine's done exactly the same format as his. And on the back page, it had a thing beginning, Monsignor Leonard is the head of the Catholic Information Office, and he is providing us with information about Archbishop of Fervor so we can, you know, arrive at the facts. And mine was like, Monsignor Leonard is head of the Catholic Information Office. He has written a very misleading pamphlet about Archbishop of Fervor, which distorts the truth, and this pamphlet is written to put the record straight. But then this was the melodramatic bit I put inside it. It's about Cardinal Newman. I hope some of you read Cardinal Newman's Apologia Pro Vita Sur, which is one of the greatest prose works of the 19th century. And what happened? By the way, if anyone wants to go now, I won't think you're rude. Please feel free to go at any time. But he was attacked by a Protestant, a very evangelical Protestant called Charles Kingsley. Most people have heard of him because he wrote a book called The Water Babies, with a little chimney sweep, you know, who ended up getting drowned. And but he attacked Cardinal Newman. He accused Cardinal Newman of duplicity because he said Cardinal Newman had been a Catholic at heart for many years before he left the Church of England, but he deliberately stayed in the Church of England to exert his influence upon other Anglicans, so that when he left, they'd follow him into the Catholic Church. Some of you might say, well, what's wrong with that? But again, that wouldn't be cricket, you see, in England. And they had an exchange of correspondence and published pamphlets about each other. Then in the end, the Cardinal Newman said, the only way really I can refute this is to tell the whole story of my life honestly, you know, straight from the heart, and then people will see that there was no duplicity at all. So he wrote the whole story of his life. So I said, really the only way to answer Monsignor Lennon is to print the whole story of the Archbishop. So I'm going to write an apologia pro Marcel Lefebvre, which Garrett, you know, it was a very melodramatic thing to do. I don't know. Perhaps one of my American friends had visited me and after a bottle of Jim Beam at the time, which happened from time to time. Anyway, when I started on it, you know, the first volume was getting on for 500 pages, only went a few years, and then the second one the same, and then the third one. There's so many documents. Probably eventually people will get PhDs actually just from reproducing it. But there will be at least five volumes now. And I very much hope the fifth volume will end up with a reconciliation. Because you see, you can't permanently, you conduct a defense of orthodoxy, I'm sure Father Ringrose would agree with this, outside the structures of the church. Although in no way whatsoever can Archbishop Lefebvre be said to be schismatic, I'm going to write about that in The Remnant, or I don't think actually he's even excommunicated, I don't think that communication is valid, but eventually, if this goes on and on for decades, you will get what I'd call a schismatic mentality being built up, and people start identifying, you know, the traditionalists as the true church, and the people who aren't traditionalists, you know, as not the true church, and you could end up with a schism. Quite a few schisms have started like that, with people who at the beginning had a perfectly valid point, but in the end they ended up, you know, as the years went by, breaking away from the church. So I think for the good of the church and the good of the society, eventually some sort of accord will have to be reached, because it's very important to remember, you know, the nature of the church we belong to. Now our Lord founded his church. He founded it as a visible, hierarchically governed body, and the church must continue to exist as a visible, hierarchically governed body until the end of time. It can never cease to be that. We can never lose the hierarchy, we can never lose the sacraments, and the church can never ask us to believe error. It can never impose error upon us and command us to believe it. That can never happen. And you cannot actually, you know, exist as a Catholic separated from the Pope. You have to be in communion with the Pope, even if he's a very weak Pope, a very bad Pope, a very liberal Pope. Well, the Archbishop, of course, contrary to, you know, some of the traditional, well, so-called traditions of Catholics in this country, he recognizes the Pope, and he insists that he recognizes the Pope, and that he's still in communion with him, unlike the ones, you know, they're called sedificentis. Some of you might have heard of people like this Bishop Vizalis and people like that. They say there isn't a Pope, which as a Catholic you can't say there is. There can't not be a Pope. When a Pope dies in between Popes, you get the stamps. If any of you collect stamps, they get quite valuable, because you get the Vatican stamps and it says sedificente on them, and all the stamp collectors rush to get those. But there is a body within the Vatican, of course, carrying the church on, to whom you can refer. If for some reason, sometimes there have been, I think, a decade or more between the election of a Pope. I know there's one occasion which the Romans got so fed up with it. That, I think, is how they started these consistories, where they're walled in. And they got fed up and they walled them in, blocked up the doors and took the roof off and wouldn't send them in any food until they elected a Pope. But all the time there was, yeah, an organ existing, so things like if bishops had to be appointed or ordinations had to take place or religious orders recognized, it could be done. And of course during the Great Schism, sometimes you had three or four people claiming to be the Pope, but always there was one Pope who was actually the true Pope. The problem of the faithful was to discern who it was. And sadly sometimes, you know, the real Pope was an utterly worthless person. Some of these so-called anti-popes were appointed because the actual Pope is such an utterly worthless person, the good cardinals couldn't stand it anymore, and they elected a really devout and holy man to be Pope, but that person wasn't the Pope. And when you get the list of the popes now, it would be the, you know, the worthless one who is put down, because once a man has been elected pope, unless he is insane, or he wishes to resign, or he's a public heretic, nobody can remove him, and nobody can judge him. And to be a public heretic, you have to, the word in Canon is pertinacity, you have to pertinaciously deny some aspect of revelation. So you would have to do something like deny the divinity of our Lord, deny the Assumption of Our Lady, deny the real presence. And this Pope and Pope Paul VI have said some very dubious things, but they've never actually written or published anything, you know, which could be, you know, taken as a, you know, as a denial of the divinity of our Lord. In their actions sometimes, that dreadful Assisi business, you could say, perhaps take that as an implicit denial of the divine nature of the Catholic Church. Mm. Because at Assisi, the Pope behaved as if every religion was absolutely equal. They even had people on chairs of the same height, so nobody looked a bit higher than the other, so it looked as if one religion was better than another. But, you see, they didn't actually have any common services together. They had this very strange statement. They didn't come to pray together, they came together to pray, and they all had their own little services. Which in itself was absolutely appalling, because nothing like this has happened in the entire history of the Church before. But it certainly didn't mean that the Pope had lost his office. Archbishop Lefebvre was greatly scandalized by that. I think for a time he was wondering whether he could believe this Pope. He said to his seminarians, can he really believe that this man is the Pope? But after a while, he felt that they had to accept it. So, as I said, you cannot indefinitely, if you're going to work to restore orthodoxy within the Church, you cannot go on indefinitely for decades and decades. You're doing it outside the official structures. So I think it's very important that eventually they have a reconciliation. I'd especially like it before the Archbishop died, because if any of all the bishops in the West, he's the one who least deserves to be excommunicated. When you think of people like Archbishop Weakland and Archbishop Henthausen, and the very idea of him being excommunicated, well, those people aren't, it makes the whole thing look utterly ludicrous. But from the point of view of history, and I think his own peace of mind, it would be rather sad if he died, even in a state of invalid excommunication. If anyone wants to know why I think it's invalid, I'll tell you. But please do, I'm sure lots of you are dying to go. Yes, sir.
Obviously, you've written a lot about the rule of faith and prayer. One tends to influence the other. Most of the last 25 years, what we've seen is changes in the way we pray, in ways, in an attempt to influence the way we believe.
Yes.
But it seems to me we're increasingly starting to see now changes in the way we believe as well, particularly with faith. I mean, you know, for example, that the original, when the Mass was originally promulgated, instructions, paragraph 7 was grotesque and replaced. But I mean, the Archbishop of Los Angeles, Archbishop Mahoney, just issued a document.
Oh, I saw that. It was unbelievable.
It's binding on his diocese, but he's openly writing. I mean, it just openly states Protestant things.
And what was weird, he published that. He thought it would put everyone's anxieties at rest, which just shows the state we're in. Because, well, as I said, you can see that it does influence the way people believe. As I mentioned, with all the signs of reverence for the Blessed Sacrament, every one of them has been abolished or made optional. One little example from my own experience. A year or so ago, I was in a parish church. I went in to buy a Catholic newspaper and said a little prayer. And there were some children in there rehearsing, I presume, for a mass, singing some appalling songs to the sound of a small guitar. And when they finished, the teacher, she looked a very nice young girl, she said, well, that's fine now, that will be all right, you can go. And all the children got up and ran out of the church, just like they ran out of school when it's playtime or recess time. Not one of them even glanced towards the tabernacle or gave a twitch. Well, those children, you have to say, they're in the post-Catholic generation. Now they don't have any belief in the Blessed Sacrament anymore. See, that's what I was trying to say when I gave the example of this hypothetical Monsignor, that these conservative Catholics, usually they know what's going on, and they try to close it off from their own minds. But if you've got the situation where 90% of young Catholics are lapsing from the faith, and I should think it's pretty high over here, isn't it, among the high school students. And then, you know, among Catholic people within their marriages now, they've had surveys, and now they find 90% of Catholics use contraceptives now. And they found the divorce rate among Catholics isn't any different from non-Catholics. And very, very sadly, they've even found the abortion rate among Catholics isn't any lower than among non-Catholics. So effectively, you know, the Catholic population has been de-Catholicized. Those who really go in for this and write letters to the paper or do engage in any controversy, a very important book you ought to get is Monsignor Kelly's Battle for the American Church. Has anybody seen that book? It's a very big book, but you ought to get it, because what he does, he shows how the church in the United States was before the council, and he shows that not only did the church teach sound faith and morals, but the people followed it. He shows, for example, on the, you know, the issue of contraception. You shouldn't, by the way, say the Catholic Church is against birth control, because you know, you've always been allowed to exercise birth control, but forget who it was, I think it was G.K. Chesterton, said contraception isn't birth control because there's no birth and no control. You know, that's a complete... What the Church condemns is contraception. You know, people wanted to abstain. It would no longer be the... So there are those three things. It must have a hierarchy, it must have a priesthood and valid sacraments, and it must teach sound doctrine. And the Church must endure like that till the end of time. But it could be a much smaller church. You see, there's no guarantee. I mentioned, actually I quoted in this little book of mine from the Catholic Encyclopedia, published I think in 1907. And it mentioned there, this guarantee of indefectibility, it does not apply to the church in any one country. And as they pointed out, whole countries have been lost to the faith. Once, really, the center of Catholicism wasn't in Rome, it was in North Africa in the time of Saint Augustine. Now there's no Catholic church in North Africa, as you know, it's entirely Muslim. Once all the Scandinavian countries were 100% Catholic. Now they have a very, very small Catholic population, and they're mostly immigrants. See, Scotland was once an entirely Catholic country. They now have quite a number of Catholics there, but they're mostly Irish immigrants. They do actually, in Scotland, being a Catholic means you support a soccer team called Celtic. I don't know if any of you have heard of it. And the Protestants have a team called Rangers, and they usually end up having a big fight among the spectators. Even among Protestants and Catholics, you never go near a church. But so the Catholic presence in Scotland now is largely due to immigrants. So you see, this promise of indefectibility doesn't mean the church won't entirely probably die out within the United States and in Britain. See, Hilaire Belloc said Europe is the faith. For practical purposes, now Europe is in the post-Catholic era. The future of the church could be in a country like Korea, where apparently in Korea there's so many people becoming Catholics that priests can hardly baptize them fast enough. In some countries in Africa, in Kenya, apparently the hierarchy there is very orthodox, and they're making a lot of converts. In Poland, they have 10,000 seminarians, which is, and as far as I know, their seminaries are very orthodox. Strange enough, that's largely due to the communists, because they as long as the communists rule Poland, it keeps the church together. But if Russians left Poland, and they let people like Charles Kerr and Hans Kung go on lecture tours, probably the whole thing would fall apart. But all that promise actually means that at the end of the world, somewhere, you know, there's going to be a group of Catholics in communion with the Pope. Father Brooke Berger, a very famous French writer, he says it could be a handful of Catholics in a dungeon with the Pope. I don't know if any of you have read Lord of the World by Robert Hugh Benson, which you can get now from the Newman Press has reprinted it. But it's all about the coming of the Antichrist, and the end of the book is absolutely amazing. It's beyond belief, and it's all very, very soundly based on the scriptural doctrine of the Antichrist. But this rather illustrates this point about the church's indefectibility. So, you know, we mustn't ever think that the church, you know, depends upon us, it depends upon the society, it depends upon Father Ringrose, it depends on, you know, any other traditionalist priest. The church can't fail. So I'm really getting much too verbose, but still, I'm amazed that you can take it. I've got to show the Falkland spirit, and I shall outlast all of you. Yes, sir.
I have your opinion on the validity of the new mass.
Well, the validity of the new mass. Well, obviously nobody has ever questioned the validity of the new mass in Latin, because all you have to do to have a valid mass, you have to have the words of consecration said by a validly ordained priest using the correct matter and form, which I mentioned earlier. It's wine and pure wheaten bread, which could be leavened or unleavened according to your rite. Now, even I've never found a really competent theologian who thinks that this business for all men or for all really affects the validity of the mass. So I don't think you can ever argue that the mass could be invalid for what they'd call defect of form. But the country where you've had most invalid masses is in the United States, but that has been for defect of matter, because many, many places in the United States have used these homemade recipes. In fact, I think I wrote a thing in the Remnant about a month ago about an Air Force chaplain somewhere who was putting recipes out. So even all these years after they were told they had to start using valid matter, some parishes are still not using valid matter. Then the other one, of course, is the intention of the priest. Now, if I go into this, we could be here all night, because a lot of you wouldn't believe me about how minimal the intention of the priest has to be. But you see, a lot of people confuse belief. They think for a sacrament to be, the technical word is confected, to confect a sacrament validly, they think you have to believe, you have to have faith that the sacrament will happen. But that isn't true at all. All you have to do to confect a sacrament validly is to be a competent minister. So, in baptism, anyone, of course, can baptize. In marriage, the spouses bestow the sacrament upon each other. But in the others, you need, you have to have a validly ordained priest to confect the sacrament. Speaking of things, it's absolutely true. A few months ago, we were doing some revision on the seven sacraments in my class for the exams, and one little girl put up her hand. She said, "Please, sir, what comes after matrimony?" And I said, "It's absolutely spontaneously. That's a lifetime of misery for the husband." They went and told all the lady teachers. They really went for me. I said, I rest my case. I prove my point. But so you see, we can take baptism as an example. Now, you've all heard the example. You could have a Jewish doctor, an atheist doctor. A baby could be born and likely to die. So the mother would ask the atheist doctor, atheist nurse, "Would you baptize my baby?" Now, all this person has to do is pour water over the baby's head and say, "I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost." Now, this person doesn't believe there is a Father or a Son or the Holy Ghost. This person doesn't believe there is a Catholic Church. This person doesn't believe anything will happen at all. So in a sacrament, you don't have to intend to do what the Church intends. If, by the way, any of you have got my book, the first edition of my book, Pope Paul's New Mass, there's a chapter on that, and it says you have to do what the Church intends, because the lady who typed it thought I'd made a mistake. And you have to intend to do what the Church does. You see, because if you don't believe anything's going to happen in the sacrament, you can't intend to do it. So you just have to do whatever the Church does. And if you do that, the sacrament will be confected. Now, the reason for that is, even in something like the Mass, you can quite often have priests, it's happened in the past, priests who've lost their faith, who don't believe in God, who don't believe anything happens in the Mass. But if they lived, say, in a society like Ireland in the 19th century, the early 20th century, the idea of a priest giving up the priesthood, you just couldn't do it. You'd be disgraced, your family would be disgraced. So they'd carry on, but their masses would still be valid. For a mass to be invalid, the priest doesn't have to believe in transubstantiation. For transubstantiation not to take place, he'd have to have what's called a positive contrary intention. So what he'd have to do, when he got to the word, before the words of consecration, he'd have to make, inside a mental resolution, saying, "I do not intend to consecrate, I don't intend anything to happen." Well, a priest who doesn't believe in the real presence, he wouldn't make such a resolution. This has happened in the past. Actually, the cases you see cited many are in the case of ordination. There was a bishop in the 17th century in some South American country who was very prejudiced against people with coloured blood in them. And he didn't think anyone with coloured blood should ever become a priest. So when he ordained anyone who had coloured blood in them, he made a mental resolution that they shouldn't be ordained. And all those priests, he admitted that when he was dying, he admitted this, and all those priests had to be ordained again. And there was a case of a French bishop who deliberately, actually he was a Mason, actually he was found to be a Mason in the time of St. Pius X, and he had deliberately excluded the intention to ordain from his ordinations, and all the priests he'd ordained had to be ordained again. But, so for the new mass to be invalid for defect of intention, you know, the priest would, you know, have to get up and deliberately exclude the intention to consecrate, which I just can't imagine any of them doing that, especially if they don't believe in it. So do you want to add anything to that, sir? I mean, you might not find that very satisfactory.
I'm questioning the fact of what they're being taught in the seminaries today, whether they really believe that the transcendental...
Yes, that is absolutely true. And probably lots of the priests today don't believe in transubstantiation. But that doesn't mean... You see, if they go up there and they think they're doing what the Catholic Church does, you see, they've probably been told, well, the Catholic Church really doesn't believe in all this transubstantiation. It's just a philosophical concept dating back to the middle of ages and doesn't apply anymore. So they might very well actually believe that nothing happens. But as long as they didn't intend to exclude it, as long as they think they're doing what the church does, their masses would still be valid. It's practically impossible, actually, for a mass to be invalid through defect of ministerial intention, unless, as the minister, he has what's called this positive contrary intention. I wrote a lot about this in a book, I don't suppose anyone will have this one, called The Order of Melchizedek. You haven't got that one as well, which I keep being asked to get that republished, but I wanted to make a few corrections in it, and I've been going to do that for about 5 years now, because I'm always getting requests for that. But I've got an appendix in it on the teaching of Aquinas about ministerial intention, and it shocked me when I read it, because I'm no theologian. You know, all the things I write about, I kind of learn them as I go along, and I was surprised when I read this. Aquinas says, to confect a sacrament validly, first of all, you don't have to believe in the sacrament, you don't have to believe anything at all, you don't have to believe that the Catholic Church is the true church, you can believe your own churches, and yet if you intend to do what the church does, meaning the church founded by our Lord, it will be valid. And then there was an example of this, I've mentioned it in Pope Paul's New Mass, in the end of the last century in Oceania, and it concerned some baptisms, and it was some Catholics had married people baptized in the Methodist branches out in Oceania, where they denied the doctrine of baptismal generation. They said nothing happened when you were baptized, it was just a kind of ceremony of welcome into the Christian community. And the reason this question was brought up, because the canon lawyers, they wanted to get the weddings annulled. And for a valid marriage, as you know, the sacrament is between two baptized Christians. So if they could prove the Methodist parties weren't validly baptized and weren't Christians, then the Catholic party could have remarried, because they would never have been married at all. And the case they brought up was particularly one of these Protestant ministers, every time he got a baptism, he got up and specifically denied what we would call the Catholic doctrine of baptism, and said nothing was going to happen. There was no original sin, no baptismal regeneration. And the Holy Office ruled, as I said, this is the end of the 19th century, the Holy Office ruled that these baptisms were definitely valid, because they said these people, they intend to do what they thought the church did in this sacrament, even though their idea of the church was wrong, and their idea of baptism was wrong, that was sufficient for a valid baptism. If you haven't ever read anything about this before, it sounds almost impossible to believe. But the reason for that is if this wasn't true, we could never know if we were receiving a valid sacrament. There are different grades of certainty. Now when, you get an admirable priest like Father Ringrose, when Father Ringrose goes up to say Mass, you can be morally certain that he intends to consecrate, and that's a very high. But you cannot believe, it sounds rather complicated, is you cannot have what's called metaphysical certainty, that it's absolute, that you could stake your soul on it, that any priest actually, you know, is orthodox and does intend, you know, to confect the sacrament. There's no way you could ever know that. And if you didn't have this protection with ministerial intention, you could never feel certain that any sacrament you received was ever valid. So our Lord obviously had this, you know, for the protection of the faithful. That probably people who never thought about this before are going to end up, would go away very confused now. But anyways, I suppose not many of you would. You see, I would. You see, as the question is regards attending the new Mass, nobody can say you know, that you can't attend the new Mass. It's a personal decision for everybody, you know, whether you want to attend the new Mass or not. But I think you definitely shouldn't attend the new Mass where there's ever any irreverence. You see, Archbishop Lefebvre, he accepts. I had a long discussion with him on this, and in the end he put it in writing that if you go to the new Mass, you do fulfill your Sunday obligation at it. But if there's any irreverence, you shouldn't go, because even though there'd be a valid consecration, that makes it worse, because the sacrilege occurs then. So wherever you get dancing girls, clowns, even I'd say even extraordinary ministers, I wouldn't even think of going to a Mass like that. But particularly if you get a priest who's preaching heresy for the pulpit, then you shouldn't go there. So I don't think this question of ministerial intention would ever be one which would be a problem for a traditional Catholic, because they wouldn't think of going to the Mass of a priest like that. I'd only use a priest like that, you're in an emergency. If I was dying in a road accident, then any priest can come and hear your confession. There is an interesting, Father Ringrose is very interested in it. Apparently he didn't know about it. In the new Code of Canon Law, by the way, if you have a case of moral or physical difficulty in getting to a Mass in a church of the Roman Rite to which you belong, it now says you can go to receive the sacraments, to go to the liturgy in any church where the priest has valid orders. That means you can fulfill your Sunday obligation by going to a Russian Orthodox church. I mean, they definitely are schismatic. So even if it was true that Archbishop Lefebvre had been excommunicated, and even if it's true that he was schismatic, under Canon 844 of the new Code of Canon Law, you're still entitled. It's a moral difficulty. I was discussing with Father earlier today, there's a thing in Canon Law, the old and the new Code of Canon Law, called a grave inconvenience, which actually doesn't have to be very grave. I believe if you lived 5 miles away from a church, you were excused from attending Mass on Sundays if you didn't want to go. That was under the presumption you'd have to walk there, you see. But that was called a grave inconvenience. And it was amazing the reasons you could be, you know, let off going to Mass for. But so it doesn't have to be a terribly grave thing at all. And if you go to Mass, if it upsets you seeing communion given in the hand, and any competent, you know, Novus Ordo priest or theologian will tell you this, if it upsets you seeing communion given in the hand, if it upsets you seeing extraordinary ministers, then you have no obligation to assist at Mass at all. There's no point in going to Mass and feeling upset and distressed all the time. Well, so, as I said in the talk, which is pretty long forgotten now, but we do have an obligation to offer God solemn worship. So, if you morally feel unable to take part in the celebration of the new Mass, what would it be better to do? Not to worship God at all, or to go to Mass, say, even if you're in a place, even a Russian Orthodox Mass, you see, that's offered with great devotion as a sacrifice. So, but it would be better, you know, to go to that than not to go at all. So you could definitely go to, you know, a society Mass. And everybody admits now that there's no doubt whatsoever that Mass is celebrated by priests like Father Ringrose, fulfill your Sunday obligation. Actually, if anyone reads The Remnant, I did a big thing on that recently. I think about 2 months ago, there's a famous thing called the Berlin Letter, where a person wrote to the, I believe he wrote to the Pope, and then he got a reply through the Archbishop of Berlin, saying that it was about society Masses, and they said these priests are validly ordained, and their Mass is in a Catholic rite, so nobody can be forbidden to go to them, and you fulfill your obligation, but on the other hand, you shouldn't recommend people to go. So, you see, under the new code of canon law, it says you fulfill your Mass obligation by being present at Mass in any Catholic rite. Under the old code of canon law, actually, by coming to Father Ringrose's Mass, you wouldn't have fulfilled your obligation, because it specified minutely all the places you had to go. It was a church or a chapel, a public or a semi-public oratory, I believe in the open air or at sea. But if you had a private oratory in your house, and for some reason, masses in cemeteries on Sunday didn't fulfill your obligation. But now if you have a priest, if you've got a relation who's a priest and he's staying with you and he says his Mass in your house on a Sunday, you've fulfilled your obligation. It's the same in the new code of canon law with priest faculties. Say, to hear confessions before, if you moved into a different diocese, say if an American priest came to England and wanted to hear confessions, he would have to get faculties from the bishop of the diocese. Now, if you've got faculties in one diocese, you can hear confessions throughout the whole world. So in many ways, unintentionally, the new code of canon law has helped traditional Catholics. That, by the way, is why, especially briefly, I don't think Archbishop Lefebvre can be excommunicated. Again, I've written a thing about this, which will come in the remnant. Because there is a canon, canon 1323, which says that you don't incur a penalty if you break a church law in a case of necessity. Now, the Archbishop thinks it was a case of necessity that he had to consecrate these bishops, but I tend to disagree with that, because I think as he was offered to consecrate one, you could argue that a case of necessity didn't arise. But then it goes on in this canon. It says, if you sincerely believe a case of necessity had arisen, even if it hadn't, if you sincerely believed it, you still don't incur any penalty. This is a kind of case what we see in England, heads I win and tails you lose. And, you know, it would seem under the new code of canon law, it's almost impossible to be excommunicated. So there can be no doubt at all that the Archbishop, you generally thought there was a case of necessity. So under the new code of canon law, if there was a case of necessity, he's not excommunicated. And even if he only believed that there was, he's not excommunicated. I've given Father, you know, quite a long study by an English canonist on that, which, what did you think of it, Father? Did you,
which was that?
The one by Father Glover.
Yes, excellent.
Yes, it was. But I think Father would agree with me. In some ways it's pleasing, but in the other way it's very displeasing that the canon, code of canon law is so wishy-washy.
Well, the thing is, you can use its weaknesses in your favor,
yes.
And that's what we see here, I think.
Yes, sir.
Did you? So excuse me one sec, sir. You're willing, we'll take one more question. We're running out of time, so this is the last question.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Did you write somewhere when Christ on the cross said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, speaking in the liturgical language, and that's why nobody understood it?
Yes, because...
What book is it that you write?
I'm not sure, I might have mentioned it. He was speaking in Hebrew. Now that would be rather the same as if someone, say in Spain, spoke in Latin. Now the difference between Aramaic, which all the Jews spoke, and Hebrew was the same, shall we say, as between Spanish and Latin. And a typical Spaniard couldn't really understand Latin. And that's why, you see, lots of people, they say, well, why are you against the vernacular at the Last Supper? That was a vernacular celebration. Our Lord celebrated in the vernacular, which is absolutely untrue. Because the Last Supper, and it still is today, is celebrated in Hebrew. And all the Jewish children have to learn. They have to learn Hebrew. And all the main prayers, when the Jews celebrate, you know, their Passover, they're still said in Hebrew. It's the same when the Jewish children have their bar mitzvah. That they're bar mitzvah, they have to learn Hebrew off by heart. And some years ago I read in the Remnant, quite a few people wrote to me about it, I wrote how I'd been to a synagogue, because the local synagogue, they wrote to all the schools, they wanted someone from each school to go there and learn about, you know, Jewish views and worship, to try and get rid of prejudice. And it was quite amusing in some ways, because it was a very orthodox synagogue, and it was really, I agreed with everything he said. He said how women have to keep silent in the synagogue, they're not allowed to speak, and the man's the head of the family. He even got on to politics, and he said the Jews, you know, according to the Jewish religion, you could have a first strike, a nuclear thing, if you thought someone was going to attack you. And all these liberal teachers, they all went out very prejudiced. But they'd all come in full of goodwill. Also, they had particularly nice cakes. They gave us all what you'd call cookies. They're some of the best cookies I've ever had. But anyway, leaving that aside, he did mention, he said one of the great things where he believed, you know, God showed his providence to the Jews is that they'd never abandoned Hebrew as the liturgical language. And he said if the Jews had abandoned Hebrew and adopted the vernacular, there would be no Jewish religion anywhere in the world now, because he said it's having their services with a large amount of Hebrew so they can go to any country in the world and take part in it. It's kept their sense of identity, and the biggest mistake they could ever have made would have been to abandon Hebrew. So that it's not even true that the Last Supper was said in the vernacular. Most of it was said in Hebrew. And also, by the way, it wasn't said facing the people. They said our Lord never used to have to turn his back to the people. But in the Last Supper, you see, the Jews always used to sit on the same side as the table, and they used to face the temple in Jerusalem. And they never sat around the tables. They were all the same way, facing towards Jerusalem. And the church has always celebrated Mass. Actually, it was supposed to be a break with the Jewish tradition, because they said the Jews worship facing Jerusalem on earth, but Catholics worship facing Jerusalem, the heavenly Jerusalem. And the heavenly Jerusalem has always been considered to be in the east. And the rising sun, you see, is considered to be a symbol of our Lord rising from the dead. And all the traditions are when our Lord comes again, the second coming, he'll come from the east, as it says, like lightning comes out of the east. And priests have always celebrated Mass facing the east. So they'll be, if our Lord comes, it's a tradition that he'll come during the celebration of Mass, so they'll be facing him. So you see, there's never been a tradition in the church. They keep talking about the priest celebrating Mass with his back to the people. That isn't the tradition. It's the Mass has been celebrated with priests and people together facing the east. And never in the entire history of the Catholic Church or the Orthodox Church, anywhere in east and west, has Mass ever been celebrated facing the people as a pastoral policy. The church is where people thought they were, like in St. Peter's in Rome. The reason the altar is positioned as it is because in St. Peter's, the apse is at the west end of the church. Most churches, you see, were built with the altar at the east end. So the altar in St. Peter's is positioned so the priest standing behind it, you see, this would be the west and the east would be over there. So he celebrates Mass facing the east. And what happened, the people would be down the two sides of the church, and they turned to the priest for the readings and his sermon. And then at the end of the sermon, he used to say, now turn to face God. And the people all turned around to face the east as well. So the priests and the people face the east together. But most of your so-called expert liturgists, they say, well, it's the tradition is Mass facing the people. Look at the Basilica of St. Peter's. But that's completely untrue. So the priests, you see, they make it seem rude. This gone are the days when the priest, it was rude and turned his back on the people. Well, that never was the case. What it is now, you see, Cardinal Ratzinger has admitted, he said, when many Catholics come to worship today, they don't worship God, it's a celebration of themselves. It's a glorification of the community. So the priest now comes in and he faces, as I said, they've got rid of the judicame, there's no talk of sacrifice. And the priest and the people, they face each other. I presume they grin at each other. and they call that going back to the beginning of the church. But it can't be, because that was never done in the beginning of the church. Start stocking the Father Kelly book. I don't know, because it's quite expensive, but you probably could, or anyone who particularly wanted it to order it. It's but the Devastated Vineyard, you definitely should give that.
That was out of print.
No, it's been actually Roger McCaffrey, the Roman Catholic books are reprinted. You can get it from the Angelus. The one you can't get now is Trojan Horse and the City of God.
That's been
has it?
Several times.
concern of book club in heaven.
Yeah,
has chosen horse in the city of God.
Conservative book club.
Right, that seems, I didn't know that that had been. There's only one book probably most of you haven't seen, is this little book I've got called I Am With You Always, which is, for this, you see, the reason I wrote it is because you couldn't get any one sort of short book on the indefectibility of the church. Another one of mine you might not have seen, even this gentleman, he might not have it, is the one called Partisans of Error on Modernism. You've got, goodness me. Because a lot of people don't know what modernism is. I mean, basically, when you get down to modernism, it means you don't believe a God exists. So that's really my favourite phrase. That's the bottom line. that you don't believe. A lot of people think a modernist is a priest that said Mass in English. But the basis of modernism is that there isn't any God, which really does lie at the heart even of things like, you see, the liturgical changes, because, as Cardinal Ratzinger said, when they say Mass now, that was reprinted in the Homiletic and Pastoral Review, that it's just a celebration of man. He said, which in itself is a celebration of nothing. And Pius X wrote that in his very first encyclical, which was called, I believe, Ars Supremi Apostolatus, and he said, we're facing in our time a great apostasy, when man is putting himself in place of God and worshipping himself. And of course that in the end has proved to be true, because nobody now even says to themselves, what is it that God requires? They say, what's convenient for me? So in a case like contraception, where they say it's convenient to me if we don't have any children for the first 10 years of marriage, so we can, go off on holidays, have a big house and do well. So they put what's convenient for them. And in the liturgy now, that, by the way, was something I should have mentioned. I really make sure you're dying to go. But that was a very significant thing in the liturgy constitution that I'm surprised people like Archbishop Lefebvre didn't spot. You see, always in the celebration of liturgy, the prime consideration has been what is most fitting for the glory and adoration of God. The liturgy constitution says the active participation of the people must be the criterion above all else upon which the liturgy is based. So the whole emphasis hadn't been what is fitting for God, is what are the people going to enjoy. And that really now is the criterion for the preparation of a Mass. Will the people enjoy this? And of course, anything, when you bring in a gimmick, when they bring in guitars, that seemed to make it more interesting, but that quickly wore off. So then they had to bring in, perhaps bring in balloons, bring in clowns, bring in dancing girls. The mind boggles to think, what eventually is going to happen. One, Tara, I'll leave you on a very depressing and gloomy note, but I've got, pretty good in my case, I don't know if any of you saw, did any of you see that issue of Fidelity magazine about the death of the head of the liturgy department of Notre Dame, if you haven't. The head of the liturgy department in Notre Dame, a Dominican, was found committed suicide in his home. And his whole home was full of all this sadomasochistic gear, all leather things and guns and whips. And he left a will saying he wanted to be buried without any Christian ceremony whatsoever. And this man, he was living this lifestyle and going in every day to give lectures on the liturgy, and he was the head of the liturgy department in your premier Catholic university, which just certainly is food for thought.
Do you have any thoughts on the invasion of that new film by Jesus Christ?
Yes.
The Last Temptation.
Yeah. Well, on this film, The Last Temptation, it's very interesting in England, it's probably the same over here. They had that dreadful film, Hail Mary, which was I think it's the most utterly vile film that's ever been made. And our Catholic hierarchy in England, they endorsed that film. They highly recommended it. And yet they the same person, a man called Nicholas Coote, who's the secretary to the hierarchy, who's a married ex-priest, actually. There's strange times when they make a married ex-priest secretary to the hierarchy. And he recommended everyone to go and see this film, Hail Mary. But he was on the television the other night denouncing this film, The Last Temptation, which in some ways is a lot milder. I suppose you could all guess why, because the Protestants have come out and attacked this film. So it's really, I think, our people are jumping on the Protestant bandwagon. It's very strange in this country because you're the most anti-Catholic people, you're Protestant fundamentalists. But it's reached the situation where, to a very large extent, traditional Catholics like ourselves have a lot more in common with just some of the fundamentalists than we have with most of the Catholic bishops.
Yeah.
Because it's very strange in this country. Now, the lead in the abortion has been taken over by the Protestants. And who is it, that nice man in North Korea? Is it Jesse Helms? Senator Jesse Helms. And the Pius X priest there sent him a letter congratulating him on his stand against abortion. And he wrote back and thanked him very much. He said, "This is the first letter I've ever received from a Catholic priest. He's supporting me in my abortion campaign." And when I started it, he said he'd imagine he'd have tremendous support from the Catholic hierarchy. And when you see, better be careful here, I hope there aren't a lot of Democrats here. So I don't see really now how a Catholic could be, you know, a Democrat with all the things they endorse. But I think basically your hierarchy is more in sympathy with the Democrats, you know, than they are with the, you know, with the Republicans, because in some ways they've got a lot of left-wing policies. But has Bush got any policy on abortion? Because both the... Yes, but probably not actively.
Well, he is now, because he's going to try to win the election that way, I think.
Yeah. But somebody, they said on the BBC TV that the one he selected as vice president, he'd been anti-abortion once, and he's sort of dropped it. I don't know if that's true. He's supposed to be strong on it.
He felt for a while that they were getting a little too radical and anti-abortion and need that.
But when you saw, because it's a different, topic, I was amazed because I watched your Democratic convention. The one I liked, everybody in England liked Jesse Jackson because he speaks so beautifully. We all like his southern accent. And his oratory is very good. But when you analyse all the speeches at this Democratic convention, not one of them actually said anything of substance, did they? How they're all going to build a brave new world, but not one of them gave. But when they said, up to now, when we get Dukakis, when we get in, the American dream isn't just going to be for the rich and privileged few, it's going to be for everybody. They didn't actually say how he was going to... But it amazes me that there probably tens of millions of Catholics are going to vote for that lot, aren't they? Which, it's not just they're in favor of abortion, but they're in favor of, so-called homosexual rights and all sorts of things. But yeah, I suppose your bishops, they won't give any leadership at all, will they? O'Connor, on a personal basis, he's quite good, isn't he, on the moral things?
Yes.
But the hierarchy as a whole, if you can get tens of millions of people, voting for someone, they call Dukakis now, they call him the Greek tragedy, which... You're probably going to be annoyed, one of the English papers, they call this man who's going to be the vice president, they call him Bush's bimbo. And they think it's a mistake, they think they've chosen him to appeal to young people and conservative voters. But some of our more responsible papers in England, they said really, if you're thinking seriously about a vice presidential candidate, it should be someone with the experience to take over the office if the president was assassinated. And they really wonder whether this young man, does have the experience behind it, but that's nothing to do with my topic. So
we want to, in conclusion, thank the St. Athanasius Young Adults Club for arranging Mr. Davies' visit to us and the lecture, and I think that will pretty well conclude things. Thank you very much.
Over here, please feel free to have someone else. Very hot. So, thank you very much for coming tonight.
Oh yes, that's right. Yeah.